history. Doing something mean to it. Doing better than anybody you ever seen do it. Screwing so lame. Got a nice ring to it. I can't tell you too great. You don't need the same music. No one man can have all that power. The clock ticking. I just count the hours. Stop living. I'm pissing off the power.
Welcome to Jim Perry Stadium here for a midweek matchup between the Charleston Cougars and the Campbell Fighting Camels. Alongside Cole Hallam, Evan Budrovich getting you set for first pitch. Last time these teams met 5 years ago, and Cole, you were a player on that ball club. As these teams get ready for midweek action today, what are you most looking forward to from the Cougars and the Camels?
I'm looking forward to a competitive matchup. Both teams are teams with regional aspirations or possibly further, so especially with as many conference games as there's going to be this year, it's going to great opportunity for these guys to face each other, a couple quality ball clubs. So looking for a really competitive, hard-fought midweek matchup.
Campbell leans on Cade Boxrucker, the freshman out of Westchester, Ohio. His first outing was maybe not his best, but a chance to learn on the fly. He threw just one inning against NC State, gave up 5 runs, but a chance for redemption here today.
It is, and these kids need to understand anytime you get to run back on that field again, it's a new chance for a great opportunity, and he's got one here tonight in a great ball club of College of Charleston, so it's time to buckle up and prove to Coach Hare that you can earn that midweek spot.
Boxrucker slides into the Tuesday role, taking on Chad Holbrook's club. Year 4 is the head coach, and this offense, Cole, just took 1 of 3 against Alabama as a team, not prolific numbers, but returned so many starters to this lineup.
They're a team that year in and year out is so competitive. They've created a winning culture over there, something that Campbell's trying to establish here as well. So they both these sides know what they're going to get from one another.
And here we go. Trotter Harlan gets things started at the plate. The shortstop hitting 290 on this young campaign. Boxrucker in his debut as a starter gave up a home run to the leadoff hitter. Another home run in that first inning. Looking very comfortable here at home.
He is. Those back-to-back fastballs on the black, and typically if a pitcher is able to get to that glove side fastball, it shows that they're composed and they're feeling good. So good start there for him.
Harlan got off to a red-hot start. 7 hits in his first 3 games. And this Charleston team is facing what Campbell will face this weekend. USC Upstate, they swept the series, did the Spartans of Upstate. And now Charleston in a rare road game, their first of the year. Boxrucker, the preseason freshman of the year in the Big South. And when you come with so many expectations, a little bit of adversity, it'll be neat to see how he responds tonight.
It is. It's a great opportunity. Anytime you have expectations on you, on top of what you're putting on yourself, things can start to mount and you start trying to do a bit too much. And right there, does a great job dialing in that fastball.
And Waldy Arias battling the wind to make the catch.
Boxrucker looks good. He's definitely got some good fastball command, manipulating both sides of the plate there and really exposing Harlan at the plate.
Defensively for Campbell, 14 errors in these first 10 games. That's a big point of emphasis for Justin Hare coming into the week. And now Joseph Mershon, the third baseman for Charleston, digs in. He goes after the first pitch and off to a great start at the plate as well. 333 hitter. It's a big challenge for Boxrucker tonight. He can ill afford to fall behind in this first inning.
And back-to-back quality opponents. He's got NC State last week, College of Charleston this week. He's facing guys that can hit, and they're not going to give you any free passes out there because you're young or inexperienced. These guys are going to try to get after you, and why not throw him back in the fire after last week and see what he's made of.
A change defensively for Campbell today. Spencer Packard goes into left, and Matt Christian plays first, trying to diversify the outfield, and here's strike two.
And what we've seen a little bit from Campbell, we've talked a little bit about defense being a problem at times. It seems to be a continuous mix of Coach Hare understanding it's early in the season and really trying to find the right formula that's going to work offensively and defensively as well.
Boxrucker on 1-2 nearly has his strikeout. Kay Bucksrucker in high school had no trouble striking out hitters. 11-0 record in his senior year. The freshman on 2-2 gives up a base hit to Marshawn, who continues a torrid start at the plate. That's his 12th hit.
And a great piece of hitting there by Marshawn, but something that Boxrucker's not gonna encounter at the high school level. That's 93-mile-an-hour fastball in the black, and really a fabulous job of hitting with two strikes, keeping the hands back. Marshawn, understanding the situation, does a great job of punching that ball into left field.
Joseph Marshawn hitches 260 last year. What a step for the second-year freshman. You can call him what you want, but an experienced player nonetheless, 2 years in. There's a check swing, and he went around. Harrison Hawkins for strike one.
A better slider there from Boxrucker as well. We saw the one against Marshawn. Kind of hang up, arm side right there. He's able to get through, starts as a strike, and finishes off the plate. Look for him to keep building on that slider, trying to find it throughout this game.
Charleston is a team 10 of 13 in stolen bases. And Boxrucker keeps tabs on that. These are two very aggressive teams. Charleston in the top third in the Colonial in steals. Campbell's in the top 10 in the country in steals. That could be a huge part of tonight's game.
It's usually a ton of fun when these two teams get together. They're very offensive. They're very aggressive. They want to steal, hit and run, move hitters, and they're capable of doing all those things. And that's what makes it such a great matchup day in and day out, is these guys can put crooked numbers on the board in no time.
You'll also see Ty Babin behind the plate. It's his second straight start. The fourth-year junior, who has been part of a four-man catching rotation. An injury to Ryan Parquette has slowed that down a bit, but they like what Babin brings behind the plate.
He does, and you can see, you know, as he works back there, but he gets so low, he creates such a great picture for the pitcher to attack, and that's a big reason why they love him so much.
This ball is smacked up the middle by Hawkins. Back-to-back singles for the College of Charleston.
Great job of hitting. It looks like College of Charleston is starting to jump on the fastball of Boxrucker a little bit. It is firm. It's not crazy overpowering. It's going to be low, topping out in maybe the mid-90s, but he's going to have to establish an off-speed pitch to get these guys off balance, because that's back-to-back hard-hit baseballs.
College of Charleston coming off a very good series against Alabama. They won the second game 1-0. Tight pitcher's duel. Did get blown out in game three. That's why their RPI now is in the top 30 in the country. Boxrucker gives up a fly ball to Ari Sakopoulos. Packard comes in, and there's the second out.
Big pitch there from Boxrucker to Sakopoulos. We talked about him getting off the fastball right there. First pitch, changeup on the outside corner. Takes about 8 to 10 miles an hour off that fastball, creates a weak fly out to left field.
Cole, how difficult is the transition? Packard's typically a right fielder. He moves across the diamond tonight.
It's simple and it's difficult at the same time, because everything is just the polar opposite of it would be in right. So you're still going to get a ton of movement on the baseball. The ball's still going to curl more down the line away from you. But you just have to understand it's going to be the opposite. There's going to be a couple balls tonight. He's going to have to understand in left field it's going to blow out a bit more here than it does in right. So just understand that, you know, false steps are not going to get you anywhere. Relax. Make sure you get the right read.
Landon Choboy takes strike one. He's the DH tonight, hitting a gaudy .444 in 9 at-bats. He's come off the bench in multiple games, but gets the start tonight. And boy, does he make it pay on that swing.
That's a good elevated fastball there from Boxrucker. Wouldn't be surprised to see him try to throw the big breaking ball off of that, finishing just below the zone, looking for a strikeout. Would be a very big pitch here with runners in scoring position and two outs.
Kate Boxrucker on 16 pitches in his first inning, trying to clean the slate after giving up 5 in his debut last week. Job well done. The slider gets him swinging, and a punch out for Boxrucker ends the first.
Thank you.
Nice job so far, guys. Appreciate it. Welcome back to Bowie's Creek. North Carolina, the weather has played very nice here this afternoon. And with the wind quiet, it could be a pitcher's good night here for both Charleston and Campbell. We roll to the bottom of the first, and Guillermo Granier warming up. And what is a critical start for Charleston. They had dropped their last two. Looking to bounce back tonight. The right-hander's got pretty good numbers. 5 1/3 innings, no runs allowed. What type of stuff should Campbell expect from the College of Charleston right-hander?
Well, they should expect pretty essentially what they would call stock right-handed stuff. It's going to be a fastball in the 90s, three-pitch mix, and he's a guy that's going to attack the strike zone. Not a ton of walks, not a ton of strikeouts. He's going to try to mix speeds and get weak contact early, so Campbell's going to have to stay disciplined in their approach, or if they start chasing these pitchers' pitches, they can find themselves making a ton of outs real quickly. So
Guillermo comes from a baseball family. His brother played at Birmingham Southern. And this College of Charleston defense, they've been very good this year fielding the ball. It's been one of their strengths. And now they look to field the ball tonight for Granier on the road. And Cole, for Charleston, they've played an all-grass field, natural field down in Charleston all year. Any type of adjustment going to a turf field for the first time?
It's not going to be huge. They should get true hops for the most part. The difference is the length of those hops and the speed of those hops. So adjusting, taking pregame, you know, BP, getting your reads, things like that. But there's nothing too tricky about turf. Once you fielded two or three, you fielded 1,000. So just try to get a feel and understand how that ball's going to move.
While Diarias skies the first pitch into right, here's Hansis towards the line. One pitch and one out.
And that's a little bit of what I think we're going to see from this Campbell offense as well as Granier. He's going to attack that zone early, so look for these guys to be aggressive. Try to find something that fits within their approach and drive early, because the deeper he gets in, he'll start nibbling on the corners and really manipulating the baseball. That makes it tough with two strikes when a guy that can go to three different pitches.
Guillermo Granier, 4 innings scoreless against USC Upstate in his last outing. It'll be interesting. The Spartans are 9-0 as a ball club. Very good team. And coming into today is Zach Neto takes ball one. They have a top 5 RPI in the country.
They're definitely a club to be reckoned with, and coming into the Big South Conference, they have something to prove. They have a chip on their shoulder, and Campbell, being the defending champions, is going to try and hold them off, but that's going to be a fun matchup as well.
That comes up this Friday and Saturday, part of a doubleheader in the final day of the series. Zach Neto returning from a wrist injury this past weekend, not only bringing a spark at the plate, but a good presence defensively at second.
He is. He seems to just slot in so well at second base. He brings a ton of energy, a ton of leadership out there. He just understands the position very well, and that's going to be big for his Campbell defense.
Now a bunt from Neto that goes foul.
I like the move there. I like the move. With his speed, he can put a ton of pressure on this defense, and if he can draw a third baseman in, you know, a step or two, it opens up a couple different options poolside for him as well.
How do you feel about that from Neto coming off a weekend where this offense just gaudy numbers? Hit 4 home runs, 6 doubles against Gardner-Webb. And now in the midweek, they go for more of a small ball approach.
I love it. I think they're trying to continue to develop and find their true identity offensively, because, yes, they can hit the long ball. They also had some chances this weekend that were created for them. They know that's not going to happen necessarily every night. So when you don't have it, you got to make sure you have a backup plan. I think small ball stealing bases is something that would be a good asset for this Campbell offense also.
Zach Neto hitting 154, although that average may not be indicative of what he brings to the table. Granier on 2-2. Good cutter for the punch out.
Granier looks good so far. Commanding the strike zone. You're right there on the corner. 88 mile an hour, just cutting away from Neto at the plate. Really a great pitch there with two strikes.
Cole, you were much better hitter than myself. Does that come off more as a slider, or what makes that pitch so tough to hit?
It comes out like a fastball. That's what makes it tough. And then it's gonna cut 2 to 3 inches typically. It's really small, but it's enough to just take it off the end of the bat and create a strikeout. It can also, you use it early in the count to miss a barrel and get weak contact. So the cutter's emerging in baseball, definitely.
Connor Denning takes ball one. He has exploded here in his second year at Campbell, a 390 clip. And more impressively, Cole, four doubles, two triples, and three home runs in the first 3 weeks.
He's done it all. He's done it all from both sides of the plate. He's also playing a great center field for Campbell starting out this season. So big asset for them.
He scoops this ball down the left field line. This is a long run for Marchand, and he runs out of room. I don't care how fast Marchand is. You got to be quick as a cat to get these foul balls.
There's a ton of foul ground here, and most of them are going to drop, especially once they make it into the brown turf area, kind of the warning track, if you will, to that brick wall.
What I love, too, is the sand granular structure of that brown turf. It helps you as a fielder, and I feel like as a player, it's got to be reassuring.
Well, and that's what the warning track's there for, is to show you, you know, it's time to start slowing down if you haven't yet, or you're going to get a rude awakening. So when you do –
you're going to have your Jose Canseco moment?
You might. And outfielders think about that stuff going into the wall. It's not comfortable, so if you can – really change the texture just to let them know, since it is all turf, it gives you a little bit more peace of mind.
3-1 to Denning. The switch hitter, who actually has equal splits right and left. You don't see that too often, as he's now slid to the top 10 in Big South batting average on the year. Grenier working behind 3-1, gives up a deep shot to right field. Denning's hot streak continues at the plate with a solo home run.
We talked about Grenier not having top-end stuff. It's going to be right around 90 miles an hour, three-pitch mix, and when you fall behind in the count, bad things happen. Really good piece of hitting there by Denning, understanding he's going to get fastball, two outs. Doesn't miss an ounce of it, hitting it off the scoreboard.
A team-leading fourth home run for Denning. That was a no-doubter off the bat.
It was fantastic. That's a really nice piece of hitting. He knows 3-1 exactly what's coming, executes a beautiful swing, and hits it the better part of 390, 400 feet.
Cole, you've had the pleasure of transferring from a community college as well. How big of a step has Denning taken from year one as a Campbell now into year two?
That's generally where you're going to start to see your big leaps is – you know, the first year you're learning so much, the curve is so steep, and the way that a school is going to go about their business is always just a little bit different from place to place. So once you start to get comfortable, you get comfortable with weight room routines and, you know, the way the offensive approach is structured, and that's when you start to see that leap of year two, very impressive, not missing pitches, and that's a great example of it right there.
That was one of the rare misses from Guillermo Grenier, left it up, and now he falls behind 2-0 to Packard. First extra base hit allowed by Guillermo Grenier this year. On 2-0, he gives up a tattooed line drive to center. Long run, looking up, and it bounces off the wall. A Big South leading Spencer Packard double machine. Give him 7 on the year.
And doubles are Packard's M.O. right there. Picks the wrong part of the ballpark. If he pulls it a little bit, that ball's probably out of the yard also, but really a great piece of hitting. He's a guy that uses the whole field so well and understands he gets himself ahead in the count too, gets another fastball, and these guys are starting to attack.
We mentioned the wind being pretty quiet. It has not slowed down the baseball tonight. A couple of missiles off the bat of this lineup, leading to maybe the hottest hitter in the country, Matthew Christian.
And I think if you're College of Charleston, you're just happy the bases aren't loaded right now.
Christian rips one foul, trying to continue a fantastic weekend. He was named the D1 Baseball Player of the Week for good reason. Two home runs and 11 RBI in a single series.
And two grand slams at that.
When you're possessed at that level, how well are you seeing the baseball?
That's, yeah, it's almost where you know what's coming. You see the spin in slow motion, and that's when hitting's a lot of fun. Most of the other time, it's just a grind of one for threes, one for fives, and you know that those good times will come. It's just the great hitters that manage the time in between the hot streaks.
Grenier facing trouble, giving up a home run and a two-out double. Falls behind to Christian.
Grenier seems to be struggling to find an off-speed go-to pitch. He's fallen behind with breaking balls the last two hitters. He's just not able to quite get it over the plate.
How about this? Matt Christian with men in scoring position hitting .580 here in the first 3 weeks. That might continue, but it's off the end of the bat. McClendon Sears camps under it. There we go. We head to the second. A solo home run for Connor Denning, the difference here in Buies Creek.
Power isn't born. It's built over time. For over 65 years, Hercules Tires has been providing the muscle to move more drivers. Whatever the vehicle, whatever the terrain, and we back it with a powerful protection plan. So wherever the road or the trail takes you, we have the selection, value, and strength to get you there. Hercules Tires, ride on our strength.
Cherry.
Tired of cooking at home? Change it up without getting up. Just order Jersey Mike's through our app for no contact delivery or no contact at the door pickup. Jersey Mike's, be a sub above.
Tasha, did you know Geico could save you hundreds on car insurance and a whole lot more? So what are you waiting for? Hip hop group tag team to help you plan dessert?
Fresh vanilla, rocky roll, chocolate.
Switch today and see all the ways you could save.
Perfect night in Buies Creek, North Carolina. Campbell leading College of Charleston 1-0. As we roll to the second, and the story of this Campbell offense this year has been the long ball, leading the Big South in home runs and giving Cade Boxrucker some support as we roll into the second. He'll start with Donald Hanses, who attacks the first pitch. Look at Colin Wolf, the shortstop, coming in, calling everybody off for the catch.
Well, if there's going to be a ball hit in the infield, you want to hit at Wolf. He's such a great leader, great defender, really can slot in at any of the three infield positions, minus first base. You won't see him over there a ton, but great job of him coming in, taking control. He is the leader of that defense.
Cade Boxrucker had an adventure of a first inning. Gave up a couple of hits, but stranded two. Now he'll face the bottom third of the order. Jared Kirvin, the catcher for the College of Charleston, rips the first pitch. Harris is in perfect position.
Well, nice catch out there by Harris. We've seen a couple different right fielders here in the Campbell platoon, but he's definitely the plus defender in right field for this defense. Gets a great read on the baseball.
Cade Boxrucker, two pitches on two outs. Will this next batter, Luke Stegeberg, even attempt to swing here?
I wouldn't. I'd lay that bat on my shoulder and get real comfortable up there to see at least one pitch. If it's not a strike, I might would see at least two.
Cole Hallam, you had the pleasure in 2015 of throwing a 1-2-3 inning on three pitches against College of Charleston. Not the immaculate inning, but pretty darn close.
It was a fluke. My stuff must have been looking pretty good that night and was fortunate enough to miss a couple barrels on three pitches.
I remember you mentioning in the pregame, the first pitch you gave up was nearly a home run.
It was, and for those of you that haven't seen College of Charleston's field, it's really short to left, and then it really jets out into left center, and that ball was caught in left center just next to that wall. If it had been 10 feet to the left, it was gone for sure.
A beautiful ballpark in Patriots Point, where their soccer and softball complexes are all kind of combined for one great park there in Charleston. This College of Charleston team picks second in the CAA. They look to get their bats going here on the season. Stegeberg taken all the way for strike one. You feel like at all that might get in Boxrucker's head knowing the hitter will take? Is that why he may have missed the last three?
It could have been because he looked to be settling in kind of right before that. And anytime you know a hitter's taking, it messes with your mind a little bit as a pitcher. And not a bad miss there at the bottom. As leads to the walk there for Stegeberg, but not a bad miss. I mean, as a pitcher, you're going to take that.
I think there's things that's called competitive walks. He might not be the team like Arizona that leads the country with 91 walks here in the first 3 weeks. You know the next highest team on that list has 72 walks. So the Wildcats are very patient.
Yeah, that's not even close. I'm imagining they must have some dangerous bats in that lineup as well, leading to some of those walks, but that's a lot.
London Sears with one out, an easy pitch to lay off. And all of a sudden, a bit of control issues here for Box Rucker, who escaped the jam in the first. His longest career outing is just an inning plus.
And what you saw in that breaking ball right there was him essentially, it was a guided breaking ball, never had much of a chance. You'd rather him just dial back in and be aggressive. Don't ever try to feel for the strike zone.
There's a strike as Sears pokes it foul. Cade Boxrucker, the unique challenge of not only having a tough start, but coming right back and being interviewed by the digital media team. He was on a documentary that group put out, and they asked him about overcoming that adversity. He said, I'm just going to clean the slate, try to hit the refresh button. Not an easy thing to do for a freshman.
It's not, but it shows a lot of maturity that he understands what it takes to be a pitcher at this level. A lot of the time, that's going to be a short memory because you're not going to go out there every night and have your best stuff. And, you know, not every outing's going to go your way, but over the course of a season, that's where great pitchers are made. And can you go out there and have, you know, 10, 11 quality starts in a year? And that's what these guys are looking for in him.
Box Rucker on 1-1 gets a nice swing and a miss. Cade has 7 tattoos that help him really calm down and find his presence. His biggest one is on his rib. It says faith. Him and his mother both have the same tattoo, and that's what unifies him with his family back at home.
Everybody's got their go-to. I used to write a couple words on my glove that when things weren't going my way, I'd take a peek at. And
Boxrucker's found his rhythm, but that's called ball two, huh?
I'm not entirely sure where that missed. That was one of his better breaking balls of the evening, but nonetheless, I guess a good take there by Sears as well.
Did not get the call from Jeff Francis. So the at-bat continues at 2-2 to McClendon Sears. The junior out of Sumter, South Carolina, who works the count full. This Charleston lineup, very patient. Top 5 in the league in walks in the Colonial so far. Granted, we'll learn a lot more about these teams in conference play when they do play more of a legit schedule. Box Rucker on 3-2. Rears the fastball, and he'll see another.
And this is going to be a big pitch here for Box Rucker. It's 3-2, two outs. And Sears understands that fastball's coming most likely. You know, but this is where, you know, can you show some maturity? Are you able to get a changeup over 3-2? Because that's going to lead you, you know, to an out. Can you throw the breaking ball 3-2? Those are going to be the pitches that as he develops and grows into this role, he's able to throw in big counts, big situations.
Another payoff pitch and ball four. Good walk by the nine-hole man, McClendon Sears, to put two on.
And Boxrucker skated out of one last inning. Couple hard hit baseballs, couple men on base, and really offense does a great job, puts one on the board in the first. Himself in the same situation. Is he going to be able to escape? I guess we'll find out, but not what you're looking for. You're looking for a quick inning, try to get those guys back in the dugout.
And a bit concerning after he got the first two men out on two pitches. He's now had to grind with a couple of walks, and he faces the hottest hitter in this lineup in Trotter Harlan.
And I think you mentioned a key point is that he looked like he lost it there for a second. Right after that second out, he just got a bit hesitant.
He might get out of it here as Grant Harris comes in. Whoa, Connor Denning makes the catch. Interesting. Well, he gets three outs on three pitches, walks two in between as we go to the bottom of the second.
Thank you.
Rolling into the bottom of the second. Campbell sporting a 1-0 lead as Colin Wolf gets things started to the plate. In that first inning, Campbell swung at the first pitch for the first five times. A patient approach here from the senior shortstop.
And part of that's just because the quality of pitch from Granier there. That's a fastball at the knees on the black. Probably not something these guys are looking to hit.
Guillermo Granier needed 15 pitches, but it felt like he had to grind through that first inning after giving up the home run. Credit the freshman right-hander in his third career outing. Working ahead on Wolf. Granier wants to make quick work of the preseason player of the year in the Big South. Instead, gives up an opposite field base hit.
A really nice job of hitting there by Colin Wolf. Finds himself in the 1-2 count. Granier's breaking ball has not been excellent right there. Not very sharp, hangs out over the plate a little bit, and Wolf's able to shoot it through the four hole. Nice piece of hitting there with two strikes.
That base hit responds after a slow start to his conference debut. Hit just 182 in that series against Gardner-Webb. You do wonder if Wolf gets going to the numbers of 2019, could that be a missing piece for this lineup?
I think he will get going. He's a guy that's so consistent.
This pitch gets away. Wolf now wants third base. Scooped up by Kervin, and that'll hold Colin at second.
Probably a good idea to stay there at second base. They were able to get a hold of it, but.
Oh, my favorite thing in baseball, the oven mitt. Got to make sure you slide that on.
You see a lot of these Campbell baseball players with them, and when you're diving in head first to second base with guys wearing spikes and you're going full speed, last thing you want to do is tweak a wrist or finger.
I think that also adds an extra 2 inches to your slide, which could be strategery.
It could be.
I made up a word there. Hope you were catching on. The 1-0 to Harris misses inside as Granier falling a bit behind with that fastball. Harris, his second straight start in the outfield. Rips a diving catch, robbed of a hit by Sakopoulos.
And a great grab by Sakopoulos over there at first base. Great job by Grant Harris there at the plate as well. Gets his pitch, rips a fastball down the first base line exactly like he's supposed to, but you know, sometimes you got to tip your cap to a great play, and that's what Sakopoulos did over there at first base on the diving catch.
The defense of the Cougars has been sharp here today. That definitely robbed extra bases. And now a meeting. Here comes a quick conversation. You do wonder here if Granier would struggle to find the zone, if this is a quick trigger or a chance to buy some time for the bullpen.
establish the strike zone, especially with multiple pitches. So Campbell started to have a feeding fest on that fastball. They understood it was probably time to get him out of there. So we'll see if Campbell can come in and mix it up a little bit.
Fourth outing for Granier, and in four innings, he's given up five runs. Charleston had mentioned us coming in. This was going to be a Johnny Holstaff type of effort from their team. We'll see how that plays out in the second inning as they get ready to take on William & Mary this weekend. That'll be back at home in Charleston. Campbell gets set to host USC Upstate, the top team in the Big South at the moment. Look at Colin Wolf getting a big secondary lead as Babin takes strike one.
And we've talked a ton about Campbell trying to steal bases. They will take third also. They're not a team that just wants to steal second base. They'll look to press the issue and see if they can slide into third as well.
Connor Campbell trying to retire the fourth-year junior catcher for Campbell. 2-1 to Babin. Ty Babin at the plate got his first career start on Saturday, hitting 125. This was a player as a freshman who was huge, a starting contributor as a catcher and a DH. Now finding a new role here in year four.
And sometimes that's just how it goes in baseball. You have it 1 year, and next year you don't. And you know, you're going to continually try to evolve and get better with your swing and timing and approach. But sometimes there's your little hiccups in between, and it's good to see him back in the lineup tonight. We know what he brings behind the dish as a pitch framer and receiver. So it's good to see him back in the lineup, though, at the plate.
Campbell taking his sweet time before the 3-1. And that forces Babin to step out. Look at the mustache on Ty Babin, by the way, as he gets rolling here in the month of March. Ripped foul past the head coach.
So are you going to be participating in Mustache March?
I've had a pretty clean face for a long time. You know, in quarantine, I had a nice set of facial hair. I can grow a beard pretty quick, but you have the beard yourself with the mustache. How do you feel? How does Ty Babin rate on a scale of, let's say, 1 to 10 with his mustache?
It's good. It's natural. It's full. I'm a big fan. It's at least an 8.5 probably for me.
That's a walk for Babin, who reaches base for the first time. Two on with one out.
Sometimes when you're slumping a little bit at the plate, a good mustache is all you need to see some pitches, get a walk.
Tough trouble for the bullpen here. Connor Campbell trying to clean up what he got himself into. And now faces Drake Pearson, the junior college transfer from Magnolia, Texas.
That's a big walk for Campbell as well. Coming in against a left-handed hitter, that's a guy you feel you should get out 9 or 10 out of 10.
Wolf doesn't fall for the bluff, and Pearson swings for the fences. That's the power that Drake Pearson brings. Double-digit home runs at the community college level last year. And looking to bring that production in the 9-hole tonight. Pearson skies one towards right. This is Hansis drifting back. There's the second out. Wolf takes third base.
And good baseball there by Colin Wolf, understanding that's a free base for him. And you're going to see Babin's stick over there at first base with the angle of the throw, just wasn't able to advance. But that was Pearson just a tick late on the fastball there, not able to get around, and leads to that fly out to right field.
Back to the top of the lineup for Campbell, and Waldy Arias digs in. This is a spot that Waldy has not excelled in, hitting with men in scoring position, just 111 on the year. And especially flipping the lineup around, they will need production in spots like this from Arias.
They will, and as a leadoff guy, his role is really subject to change the most out of anybody in the lineup, because anytime you're leading off an inning or a game, you understand guys are going to come right at you with fastballs. But typically at the college level, when you have runners in scoring position, two outs, sometimes a base open, you're going to get heavy off-speed, change-up, breaking ball, things like that. They're not going to give you anything too good to hit with as much damage as you can do with runners on. So he's going to have to adjust to the change in the way that he's being pitched, especially in these situations.
Ground ball to second. Quick work from Connor Campbell out of the pen, keeping this a 1-0 game as we go to the third. Hi, Kevin. Welcome back to Jim Perry Stadium. Time now for the top of the third inning, and also time for the top of the College of Charleston order. 2-3-4 in the attack for the Cougars. And Joseph Mershon battling Cade Boxrucker at 31 pitches as the freshman Cole's gotten himself both in and out of trouble here tonight.
I think he's definitely going to take the results. Anytime you put zeros on the board, you're going to take it. He's had some self-inflicted issues, but he's been able to escape. And with the type of stuff he has, you just would love to see him dialed in and see what he's capable of when he's hitting on all cylinders. And I think if he continues to fight his way through this year, close to the end of the year, we're going to see him start to peak and grow into who he's going to be as a pitcher.
Mershon broke off a tough series against Alabama, 1-for-10 with a single in the first tonight. And he's ahead 2-0.
Sometimes all you need as a hitter is just a little bit of new scenery and different backdrop to pick up that ball a little bit better.
Boxrucker gave up 5 runs in his last start. He has settled in the third, pound strike one. Justin Harris, high praise for Cade Boxrucker. They want him to be a midweek starter throughout the year. And I do wonder, with conference play kicking in for Campbell, has he shown enough to maybe slide him into a midweek start against a conference opponent?
I think a lot of that depends on what we see tonight. I think you can chalk up the NC State game as not your night. You're young. A couple things didn't go your way. But, you know, as a coach, Coach Harry understands that that's not necessarily an accurate depiction of who he is as a pitcher and how he's going to really shape out against conference. So if he can battle through tonight, he's been in some big situations, and we'll see what happens. But there with another walk, a leadoff walk at that, it's if you create enough bad situations, bad things will happen. He's got to really start getting ahead of the College of Charleston hitters.
Third walk and 4 batters for Boxrucker, who has electric stuff. As we mentioned, the top-rated prospect in this league is a freshman coming in. Now he faces the heart of this lineup, Harrison Hawkins. Hawkins trying to get his back going as he takes strike one. In fact, hitting just .216 on the year. Did rip a single over the head of the pitcher the last time up, and there's got to be no better feeling for Hawkins.
No, and I think that part of that is why we saw the leadoff breaking ball there from Boxrucker. I don't think anybody's going to second-guess you when you talk about his talent, but it's a matter of filling in right there and being able to dump back-to-back breaking balls over to a middle-of-the-order guy. That's the difference between a really good high school pitcher and a really good college pitcher.
He goes right back to it, jump up nothing and two. Battling the Florence Darlington Tech transfer. That slider is kept up and knocked out of play. Pretty well struck by Hawkins that time.
and one that Boxrucker got away with. Back-to-back really nice breaking balls to start. That's the one that's been backing up we've seen for the majority of the game that hangs up in the top of that strike zone.
Boxrucker, the freshman arm of Westchester, Ohio, trying to settle in for his third career outing. Pitch inning scoreless out of relief. That was gave Justin Hare confidence to move him into the rotation here tonight. Runner is off 0-2. Babin throw to second, a bit offline, and the tag is just late.
And you said it early, these guys are going to steal. They're going to be aggressive on offense. Neither side really has gotten the bats going thus far and has looked great at the plate, so we should see some small balls, some bases stolen, guys trying to press the issue and manufacture a couple runs.
11 steals for the College of Charleston. That's fourth best in the Colonial. I don't think many teams are going to catch Louisville for the nation's lead. 32 steals in 3 weeks. And that's a couple of conference series for the Louisville Cardinal.
Anytime you can steal bases, you put yourself in a good advantage. You have defenders that are in motion while the ball's being hit, and that creates a big, big advantage for the offense.
Just seeing the D1 poll, there are six ACC teams ranked this week, and it's programs like Pitt, Boston College, Miami, some newcomers to the poll. Some of the favorites like NC State and Duke have fallen out of the rankings. It does make for a topsy-turvy league this year.
Well, I think there's going to be a lot of mix-ups in some of these conferences because of the number of guys that are involved. And you know, you have guys that are leaving big programs, going closer to home, or you know, jumping from smaller programs to bigger programs. So there's so many good, talented players in college baseball this year, and it's really going to be interesting to see who ends up at the top when it's all said and done.
Line drive down for a hit. Hawkins in the center. Here comes Mershon looking to score, and in there safely to tie this puppy up at one. RBI single for Hawkins.
And he saw too many hung breaking balls, was finally able to get the bat on one. Punches it right back up the middle again, does a great job of hitting, picks up his RBI. Denning essentially had no shot, probably is going to wish he pulled that ball down to the cutoff guy with Hawkins moving up on the throw to second base.
Good piece of hitting for Hawkins, who now has two hits today. This after not picking up a hit in the Alabama series. Nice bounce back effort.
It is, and you know, I mentioned it a bit earlier, sometimes all a hitter needs is a change of scenery. It's no drop of talent with Boxrucker stuff on the mound. Sometimes you just need a new look and really a fresh start on a ball game, and that's what they have here on this Tuesday.
Boxrucker falling behind now to Ari Sakopoulos. One run on three hits for each team. Coming different ways. A solo home run for Campbell, a string of hits for Charleston these last two innings. One oh is ripped foul. You think about the Colonial Athletic Association, Charleston and UNCW, two of the favorites in the league. And last year, Charleston started 12-2. They were rolling in non-conference probably before the season shut down due to the pandemic.
And that's tough, especially when you have those high expectations. You've worked so hard to get to the year. It's all going according to plan to start out, and then it disappears. Are you going to be able to find, you know, magic lightning in a bottle again? Because it's in college baseball, it's really hard to win a weekend series, let alone go 12-2.
It'll be interesting in that league this year in the Colonial. They'll do a double round robin plus interdivisional series, whereas the Big South is elected to double down on conference play. They'll have 40 conference games and then decide a champion with a four-game tournament.
It's going to be absolutely wild to see how it shakes out with conference standings, RPI, who these teams are able to play, and who are they able to reschedule. I'm assuming there could be some hiccups with you know, COVID being out there. Are series going to be canceled, and are they going to be able to reschedule, and how's that all going to shape out? It's definitely going to be interesting to see all the moving parts come together.
Here's Tyler Robinson, the pitching coach, and he just saw what all of us in the ballpark noticed. Boxrucker is struggling to find the zone here, forcing that meeting at the mound.
I think he just went out there to calm his young arm down, let him know he's, you know, it's one run, it's not the end of the world, you need to compete, we can't let this thing really get out of hand early. And he's also stalling to, as you see the arm in the bullpen warming up. I mean, the last thing you want to do is get a merry-go-round going before you have anybody warm.
Here's a line drive, snagged by Christian. There's the first out of the inning, moving the runner up and Hawkins to third.
And Matthew Christian looking pretty comfortable over there at first base.
24 years old, riding that car at first base pretty comfortably.
Yeah, he spent some time on a baseball field.
He is one of the older players in college baseball, but this past week he was named the National Player of the Week in college baseball, so he's sitting on top of the mountain right now.
Usually we're talking about his hitting. I think it's no surprise to find that Coach Harrell is going to put him all over the field in order to keep him in the lineup.
This is Landon Choboy with one out in the inning. A lot of aggressive swings from Charleston early in the count. Very patient that time from Choboy.
They've done a great job of getting their best swings off on pitches in the zone. You know, you've mentioned that they're not a huge chase team. They haven't chased a lot and really bailed Boxrucker out of much. So as long as they keep doing that, they should be able to keep some pretty good pressure on this Campbell pitching staff.
Two and zero from Cade Boxrucker, who now sits at 49 pitches. He's got some work to do against this savvy College of Charleston lineup. A team that, according to D1 Baseball, is a sneaky at-large team in their regional projections. Wilmington, the favorite in the league, they could be a very good three seed. But teams like Northeastern and Charleston could be very dangerous as their strike one.
Two teams that everybody knows what you're going to get from them. They're going to battle it. Also, two teams that Campbell's very familiar with, guys that they've played in the past. And it's always fun when you get a couple old rivals back together.
Landon Choboy hit a team best 371 last year. Now he gets a 2-1 count. Taking strike two.
And better breaking balls there from Boxrucker. Those are probably two of the better ones he's thrown this inning.
So what has Choboy done since? Now he's hitting 400, as if that was not a flash in the pan. He's got a big spot with a runner at third and one out. Boxrucker on 2-2. Gives up a line drive off the glove of Arias. Everyone is safe, and Waldy saves a run.
No out on the play, but a huge play by Arias. Coach Hare talks a ton about his range and his defensive prowess. Right there, that was almost a for sure double off the bat down the line, and really a great snag by Waldy just to knock it down at all.
It's crazy on that play. Could have been a double play, could have been a double. And also could have been an out. There's so much going on in that line drive. Instead, the inning continues with one out for Donald Hansis, who is rated one of the top 20 prospects in the Colonial Athletic Association in terms of pro potential down the road. Tries to get his bat going now, hitting 200 on the year. And that hits him. The bases are loaded for the Cougars. And that does not look pretty there for Hansis, who takes it awkwardly.
It didn't look good. It definitely didn't sound good. It looked like a 92 mile an hour fastball or so right off the knee, and that's going to be a tough one to walk off.
I hope for the best as Hansis heads down. Six years since these teams last met in 2015. Campbell has led the all-time series 14-12. What we've seen is a very competitive ball game here in the first two innings as Tyler Robinson's made up his mind. A pitching change is coming.
And there's just been too many instances where Boxrucker's played with fire. It seems like Charleston's had people on every inning, and you know, let alone second, third base, you know, one out, no outs, and after a while, you just got to get them out of there, get somebody in there that's going to limit the damage and limit the exposure that you put on your defense.
Campbell with a pitching change. We'll take the break. Big spot for the Campbell bullpen. We return.
pitching for Campbell. Number 31, Logan Heitzman.
Campbell forced its hand to the bullpen. And now Logan Heinzman coming in with the bases loaded here for Charleston. Heinzman in 8 innings has given up 5 runs, maybe his toughest spot of the year inheriting this jam.
It's going to be a tough jam, no doubt, but not one that he's unprepared for. Typically a role we're going to see Heinzman is in, and it's a tricky situation early in a ball game. He's going to be Campbell's long relief option, so we'll see if he's able to get out of the sticky one here.
Here's Jared Kirvin, the catcher, looking for his first RBI, and what a spot to do it here in the third. Ground ball, Wolf. This would be huge. The turn from Neto. Heinzman gets the job done. We go to the bottom of the third. It's still tied at 1.
In the last 10 years, Emerge Orthopedics has really been on the forefront of doing orthopedic urgent care. We realize that a lot of these accidents happen after hours, and patients want to get seen and get diagnosed and get taken care of. Emerge has a number of orthopedic urgent cares throughout the Triangle, and some of which are open 7 days a week, open till 9 o'clock at night, and that's been a huge benefit to patients. Patients routinely give us compliments on that and the care they receive there.
We are not merely an institution of higher education. We are transforming lives and empowering students to become leaders.
Leaders in our communities,
in our state, and throughout the world.
Leaders in innovation.
Leaders in service to our neighbors.
Join our movement. Join our community. Join our mission. Lead with purpose. Lead with Campbell.
Crust is the most important part of stuffed crust.
It's half the name.
Papa John's crust is made from 6 simple ingredients. 7 if you count all this cheese! Better ingredients, better pizza, Papa John's. Papa John's is known for its crispy, fresh crust full of warm, fluffy pockets. And now they're known for stuffing those pockets with cheese!
I love you, cheese.
Get a new epic stuffed crust pizza with 1 topping for just $12. Papa John's.
Welcome back to Jim Perry Stadium. Picture perfect night here in Buies Creek, North Carolina, along with Cole Hallam, Evan Budrovich with you for the bottom of the third. And Connor Campbell is pitching against the Campbell Camels. Always kind of neat in that regard. And to Connor's credit, got out of a jam in the second. Now he'll face Zach Neto, who turned a huge double play a moment ago.
He did. We've talked about the life that he brings to this defense, and he's really done such a great job in getting inserted back in the lineup, coming off a bit of an injury, and looking for him here to continue building on it offensively as well.
Neto smacks the first pitch foul. A bat that was certainly welcomed in this order, especially when you add his defense in that as well. And what did he do in the last series? 1-for-4 with a run scored. Neto went down to Florida last summer and dominated in the summer collegiate league. K Campbell on 1-1. Misses outside. Cole, how does that confidence translate from a collegiate league back to your regular team and into the regular season?
Well, a lot of these guys go play in the summer leagues because it doesn't necessarily matter where you have success. If you're able to figure something out and you know, find more comfortability with your swing, be able to execute better, it's something that translates. You're facing great quality talent in these leagues with all the exposure and all those things. Kids are out there getting recruited, getting scouted, and it's just a really great opportunity for development and a ton of at-bats, a ton of time to play baseball.
This was a kid out of high school who was an All-American hitting .442 outside of Miami as he chopped that one for strike two. We asked Justin here, will we see him both as a pitcher and a hitter this year? A little less on the pitching side, but he does bring good pop from the plate. Recruited as a third-base shortstop product. Now battling Connor Campbell on 3-2. Fights it off. So Granier goes an inning and a third, gives up the home run to Denning. And now Campbell in his second inning of relief, working the count full to Zach Neto. Ball four, leadoff walk for Neto.
And we've seen a couple leadoff walks. Those are ones that as a pitcher typically come back to haunt you. Really opens up what Campbell's looking to do offensively. And we saw a little bit of it from College of Charleston as well with stolen bags, creating some tempo, creating some pressure on the defense. We'll see if Campbell looks to expand on that here as well.
How about this? Neto, part of a unique offense. 9 different players have stolen a base this year, including Neto, who's 1-for-1.
And that's tough. It's tough really on a pitching staff. You know, you understand the pressure as you see him pick there. He's fully aware of the situation anytime a Campbell runner gets on base. But, you know, as a pitcher, it's so tough to manage the running game and deliver quality pitches. You're going to typically see guys back up breaking balls and leave pitches higher in the zone. That's why it's so important to have guys on when you're hitting.
Denning moves to the right side for this at-bat and works ahead. And all of a sudden here, a quick timeout. Pitching coach Will Dorton sprints out there in a hurry. He must have noticed something from Campbell.
It could have been a little tweak or an awkward movement from him. Looks like he's just going to go check on his health and make sure it was just more of a fluke thing rather than a possible injury.
We also want to thank Will Dorton. We found him pregame, went over a couple of the pronunciations to double-check the name. There's some difficult names, regardless of the pronunciation sheets these great sports information directors give us. There were some tricky ones on this roster. So Campbell looks to be all right. The 1-0 is grounded to second. Perfectly positioned for one, Staggerberg. The turn by Harlan.
And Campbell must have been feeling pretty good on the mound. Gets to stay out there, executes the fastball down in the zone, creates a great opportunity for a double play, and we've seen a ton of good defense. No surprise to see him turn it successfully.
College of Charleston, this is their strength. 15 double plays turned. That's top 5 in the country.
And a lot of that is kudos to your pitching staff. You have to understand how to pitch to ground balls, pitch to create, you know, double play opportunities. They do such a great job, and no wonder why when you have a defense behind you that's as good as theirs.
Trailing just Georgia State for the most double plays. They have 16 of them. And now Packer with a clean slate takes ball one. Charleston started the year with 2 straight wins. They've now dropped 6 of 7, but looking strong tonight. There's ball two to Packer. Spencer Packer with his 7th double. That's a Big South leading 7 doubles in his first at-bat. Reminds me a bit of his 2019 season where he had 20 doubles, was one of the most prolific hitters in this lineup, and carried that offense to a regional berth.
It just seemed like every time he was at the plate, he was standing on second base. And a lot of it's due to his discipline offensively. He's not going to swing out of the strike zone. He's not going to get out of his game plan. He's a guy that really is prepared to hit and uses the whole field, and typically when you find those gap-to-gap guys, you're going to find a ton of doubles, and he's done a great job doing that.
This ground ball might stay in play. Nope, just foul. Kind of surprised there. Sakopoulos let it come to him a little bit. Yeah, that's a tough read right away, I imagine.
It's tough. That ball had a ton of spin on it as well. Last thing you want to do is blow by it in fair territory and just misplay it a bit, and it turns what should be an easy ground ball out into a single or an error. But those ones down the line can always get a little bit tricky, especially spinning on the turf.
The 3-2 ripped off the mound. Second hit for Packard, who now has a double and a single tonight.
And continues to execute his plan at the plate. He's a guy that will exhaust a pitching staff. You'll find him in full counts, 2-2s, 3-2s, all the time. It's a place where he's comfortable, and why not when you can work through a count, punch a single up the middle. Really a great job showcasing how good he is as a hitter.
This conference, the Colonial, the Big South, they've met six times this year. The Big South Conference 5-1 in those meetings, with Upstate sweeping the series over College of Charleston last week. Not something you see very often. In fact, last year, the Colonial had like a 3-1 record, wins and losses against the Big South. It's unique how it can flip in one season.
And all it takes is one good team. You talk about Upstate rolling hot right now, and I think, you know, anybody in the country is going to have a tough time beating a team that is just winning ball game after ball game. It seems like when the going's good, it's good. And what College of Charleston is going through right now a little bit is, you know, it's not going so good. Those are the funks that are tough to get out of, and you know, it seems like everything's kind of going against you. The ball's not bouncing your way.
Christian skies one into the air here on this perfect sunset night. Hanses comes in and retires the red-hot Christian. Let's go to the fourth. A 1-1 ball game here on a perfect Tuesday night. Couple of Campbell University students enjoying the ball game here in the fourth. How about that kid texting all by himself? Must have something important to say. You see the women's tennis team waving to the camera here out of the timeout. Boy, that guy on the left was not a very happy camper.
Not happy at all.
It's a good ball game here so far. I imagine you got to be in a good mood watching this one tonight, along with Cole Hallam, Evan Budrovich with you here on ESPN+.
65-degree afternoon with the ball game on. That's going to be tough to beat.
Logan Heintzman back out for his second inning, and he did a fantastic job forcing a double play ball to get out of that jam in the third.
He did. That's his bread and butter. He's a guy that throws a ton of strikes. He will cut the baseball a little bit, and he's also able to, you know, throw off-speed pitches early in counts. So he is their long relief guy. I think they're probably banking on him hanging around here for a couple innings.
First pitch, a ground ball to Colin Wolf, and one quick out.
And that's exactly what they're looking for from him. Come compete early in counts, get these guys out, but you know, force them to put the ball in play and keep the defense involved. That's going to be, you know, the key to having good defense behind you. Is, you know, you can't be sluggish, you can't have a ton of walks. So you need to keep them in tempo and focused on the game.
One gone by for McClendon Sears, the center fielder. And that is called a strike, nothing in one. This will be an interesting inning for Logan Heintzman. Campbell has used him as a starter and a long reliever. And you'd imagine if you're Justin Herr, you want to get 3 to 4 out of him tonight to extend to the back end of the pen. On cue, a ground ball up the middle. Great snag by Neto, but keeps it in his pocket.
Really showing off a ton of range just to get to that baseball. Sharply hit by Sears right up the middle. And, you know, Neto's able to snag a glove on it, not able to get the body turned to deliver a throw. But nice show of range, to say the least.
Instead, Sears with his first hit of the night. This Charleston lineup in 2019, they were prolific. Hit nearly 300 as a team. They have a lot of bats returning, including Trotter Harlan at the top of this order. Harlan attacks the first pitch. Denning able to drift his way back and make the catch. Cole, that's two times around the lineup now, and I've counted 8 first pitch swings, and a bunch of those have resulted in outs.
And it could be part of their approach. These guys are going to want to get after the Campbell pitchers early. They know that they can strike guys out when they get to those two strikes. So if you get something early, try to jump on it. We've seen a couple balls hit hard, not probably as many as they would like, but if you're going to be aggressive and be good at it.
Two gone by for the Cougars here in the fourth. This is Joseph Mershon. Kind of has that Pablo Sanchez stance from the left side of the plate for strike one. By the way, an underrated character in backyard baseball. How about Keisha Phillips? She had some pop from the right side.
She did. She did. Pablo was a go-to, though. First round pick there every time.
You always have to pick like Kurt Schilling or Randy Johnson, too, to have that big leaguer on your pitching staff. As Heintzman keeps tabs on the runner. The one I was really into was backyard football.
Really?
With like Jerry Rice and Steve Young, where they could play with each other.
Did you play NFL Street at all?
I did. I was not very good at it. Yeah. That's kind of what limited my video game playing.
Great game, though. Great game.
Heintzman trying to navigate through this inning. Forces weak contact to Christian. Covers the bag and plays the game himself. Good work to end the inning. Let's go to the bottom of the fourth. Ask AJ, can we get Corey Gensler back on camera again? He looks so happy. Is he over there? Oh, hey, Lendl. Yep. Oh, no. My car got hit? Oh, geez. Lendl. Picture perfect night. Look at that cursive camel script right across the middle of the turf. This is a 5-year-old ballpark finally open. And Cole, you played in it year one. What's it like to have a home turf field to accompany your everyday work?
I loved it. We spent a ton less time cleaning the field and a lot more time trying to get better on it. So love the maintenance part of it. Does get a little bit warm in the later spring, early summer months, but as long as I'm not raking the infield and fixing, you know, all kinds of divots in the outfield, I think I'll take it.
Colin Wolf leads things off in the fourth. Chops one right on top of the turf. Tough turn for Campbell. And in time. Would he have been safe if he ran straight through?
That's what I was – I'm not sure how I feel about the head first slide. Love the effort. I don't know that mathematically or scientifically – if it makes sense.
Wait, hold on. It's got to be a scientific thing.
I think
it's physics. It's an angle.
It
right?
could be a little bit of both.
Is math more of a speed thing, like a velocity? E equals MC squared, something like that?
Yeah, something like that.
You can tell neither of us are on the high end of that equation. Here's Grant Harris with one gone by. I also was told during the break my car got hit. I hope my Subaru Forester's all right. I got to get my new plates coming up for the new year. Grant Harris has been tattooing balls on the year, including a line drive to first his last time up, robbed of a base hit. Does the same this time. And look at the snag at second. Stagerberg takes away a hit.
We talked about how good they were defensively, and that's back-to-back robberies of Harris there on two sharply hit baseballs and great range, ability to stay with that baseball by Stagerberg and deliver a strike over to first base.
Two quick outs for Connor Campbell here in relief. And this College of Charleston defense, they've been very sharp tonight.
They have. They've not only made the routine plays exceptionally well, but they've also taken away a couple hits from the Campbell offense.
Ty Babin tries to extend the inning as he bunts his way and takes strike one.
It's not too often you see a catcher squared a drag bunt trying to create a base hit.
Especially with two outs after the first two hitters got retired pretty quickly. So Babbitt in his headshot has a full beard that takes up probably 3 to 4 inches. You see that freshly shaven face. That actually started in March, and he's letting the mustache grow out. So it's kind of a unique look.
I'm a big fan of the buy-in.
There's strike two. Connor Campbell now at 35 pitches, giving up just one hit in 2 1/3 innings. On 1-2, trying to make quick work at Babin. Ty Babin, the Student Athlete Advisory Committee rep for this program. And Cole, as a student athlete, how important is it to have a player you can lean on to voice concern or just to have someone you can trust inside your program?
It's nice just having, you know, one guy that you can go talk to. And everybody has, you know, maybe their own guy, but he speaks for the majority of them. And He's such a veteran presence. He's a calm head. He's a guy that, you know, has probably been through a lot of situations and really does a great job of advising these guys on how to handle them.
Babin, the fourth-year junior from Jackson, New Jersey, spent his high school career here in Holly Springs, North Carolina. Takes strike three. Quieted by Connor Campbell, who's rolling in the fourth. We go to the fifth here in Buies Creek. Getting a look at the dugout for the College of Charleston Cougars. Ball club playing their first road game on the year. And a team trying to return to their regional success, Cole. They made the Super Regionals in 2015. This is a club that has high expectations as one of the favorites in the Colonial.
They look good. They look good offensively. Ton of good swings, aggressive approaches. And it looks like they're going to steal some bags and be able to create runs differently there as well. And they've looked good on the mound, so with their defense, you know, if they're able to put up some runs, they're going to pitch it pretty well. They're going to play good defense behind them.
Logan Heintzman has been cooking out of the bullpen. He goes back to work. This is a unique matchup, too, because you have a Campbell team that's the favorite in the Big South, along with Upstate, Charleston right there with UNCW. And while it may not be a regional preview, it has the feel of two regional-type teams playing tonight.
Oh, it's definitely a big game, and we've mentioned kind of the way these teams are approaching conference play, and you know some teams aren't going to be able to get out of conference as much, so they understand there's RPI potential on the line as well, and these guys are, you know, they're competing for at-large bids, they're competing for conference championships. There's just a ton of things on the line, and that starts early in the season, and it starts midweek this year as well.
Hawkins works high inside for ball one. Harrison Hawkins off to a slow start, but Logan Heitzman has not, especially in this game, hitting a two-thirds scoreless.
I think, you know, Heinzman brings an interesting matchup. You talk about how often College of Charleston has swung at the first pitch. He is a guy that's going to pitch in the strike zone, so he could get a lot of outs in a hurry with just a few pitches if he's able to execute early in the count.
On cue, he pins the corner for strike two. Because this Charleston offense last season, now it was a smaller sample size, 291 average, and more importantly, they were top 10 in the country in RBIs. They were driving in runs at a premium.
I think they can still get to that. A lot of the time, you know, the beginning of the season doesn't tell the whole story. It's a few of your guys are going to be notoriously hot starters. A few of your guys are going to be notoriously slow starters. So all those things will balance out over the course of the next 50 games or so, and you'll see those numbers, and I think they'll reflect somewhat similarly.
Here's the 2-2 from Heinzman. Hawkins pops it up. Christian drifts back. Neto cuts him off and makes the catch.
Nice play there by Neto, and that's what they know they get when they put him back in the lineup defensively. He's got a ton of range. We've seen some hiccups on defense from Campbell, but he's a guy that's solid over there on the right side of the field, goes over there, claims the fly ball, and kind of no man's land, so great job seeing him back in the lineup.
So if you're Matt Christian, what type of advice do you give the young kid there? Do you give him the piece of candy? Like, how do you thank him for making that catch? Because that's a long way to run for Christian.
I think you keep hitting home runs. You keep hitting grand slams and hitting guys in when they're on base. That's your job over there, big fella, at first.
Because Matt Christian was a quarterback when he started his college career. He knows how to direct an offense. He knows how to feed an offensive line when they make big plays. How about that changeup for a strike two?
He is a three-pitch guy up there, Heinzman is, and that's what enables him to be, you know, a starter or a long reliever is having that third pitch. He does such a great job of mixing all three.
That was a huge project for Heinzman at the end of 2019, develop that changeup. He's worked well on it, and it comes out tonight. Instead, he goes to the fastball, and Harris scoops, does not make the catch. That's a base hit for Ari Sakopoulos.
Pretty risky play out there by Harris, too. Charging that ball, wanted to make a play on it. I think saw that ball was diving with the top spin a little bit more than he thought off the bat, but able to knock it down and hold him at first base. That's a nice job out there.
It was a late slide by Harris, but kind of a smart one, too. You don't want that ball to sneak away.
No, you'd definitely rather body up, because if that ball gets by you, it's going to be a merry-go-round as you run back to the fence to pick it up.
Heinzman facing Landon Showboy, who was red hot last year. Continuing that success here at 455. Rips the first pitch in the left, and there you go. Second hit for Showboy.
Nice job of hitting there. If you are going to get to Heinzman, early is the way to get to him. Jump on the fastball. It's not as high-end as some of the other arms here. It's going to be right in the high 80s, touching 90, 91 miles an hour. So if you're going to get him early. That's what we're seeing them attack and continue those first pitch swings and early count swings as well.
This is the second time around the order now for Logan Heinzman in relief of Cade Boxrucker, the freshman starter. Donald Hanses takes outside. You do wonder in this midweek matchup how Campbell will utilize its bullpen. Quiet at the moment. It's not like Heisman's throwing a lot of pitches, just 15, but a little bit of trouble starting to come here.
It is, and they're just going to have to adjust the pitch sequence. They're starting to jump on fastball early. If he's able to mix it up, go to changeup here with the left-hander, Hanses at the plate, I think it's a good opportunity to get a ground ball, possibly get back in the count. But
there's your changeup, but he missed it.
And it's a good miss. It is a hitter. At least now you have to respect it. It's going to make that fastball look a little bit firmer. But he's going to have to start getting ahead of these guys with other pitches if they're going to continue to jump fastball early.
Donald Hanses, him and his sister, both at College of Charleston. She plays on the softball team right across the street. And honestly, it's not even across the street. It's like basically one combined complex, really, with the soccer fields all mixed in together.
It's a great complex, actually, as well. They have a great environment for baseball. Haven't been to a softball game over there, but the baseball environment is definitely a fun place to play.
Big reason why Chad Holbrook took this job as a former assistant at UNC under Mike Fox and at South Carolina as well. There's a strike one from Heintzman trying to avoid loading the bases. There's lots to like about this program for Charleston. They are coming off a series loss against Alabama, which is no slight by any means, taking one of three. Now looking for their first road win and their first road game as well. There's strike two.
I think the Charleston dugout thought that ball might have been a bit down.
Sounds like it. It's a patient club with the play, and it's gone from 3-0 to 3-2.
And I'd love to see Heintzman go back to the changeup here. It is so good. It's very potent against left-handed hitters. We'll see if he's got the confidence with first and second, one out, full count. It'd definitely be a big pitch.
Our first real sign of energy from either of these teams tonight. In a rare midweek game between Campbell and Charleston Southern, first meeting since 2015. The payoff is swung on and missed. Good use of the changeup.
And that's the veteran move right there. Going back to the changeup with a full count, that's exactly how you draw it up with the left-handed hitter sitting dead red fastball. Execute your pitch, get you a cheap strikeout right there. Great execution by Logan Heintzman.
It's his first strikeout of the night, and it comes in a critical spot. One big box to check. Jared Kervin checks his way in. Kervin grounded into a double play his last time. I'm trying to cash in Arisopoulos, who goes on the pitch, pulling Waldy away from the baseball, collects his feet, and makes the play to first. We remain tied at one halfway through tonight's proceedings here on ESPN Plus. Shot of the night from our crew here in Buies Creek, North Carolina. What a beautiful skyline as we get you rolling here in the fifth inning. Cole, that's perfect weather to pull out your phone, take a picture, and just enjoy that sunset here in North Carolina.
That's a tough one to beat. Perfect weather here tonight. Baseball back in action. That's tough. That's beautiful.
This is a rare road game for this College of Charleston program. They started the year with 10 straight at home. And they'll actually play four more at home before hitting the road for Charlotte in a couple of weeks. Here's Connor Campbell, who's done a nice job in relief, 2 2/3 scoreless. What's impressed you about the left-hander in relief?
He's come in. He's done a great job of getting after Campbell hitters. He's attacking the strike zone, mixing speeds, and it just looks like he's got some great competitive stuff out there, and he's not afraid to get after these guys.
It's Charleston bullpen. Last year they were the top ERA. This year they've drifted down to sixth or seventh. And it is a very small part of the season, so tough to tell. But there's some quality arms in relief here.
There is, and I would imagine we'll see another, at least probably two of them here tonight as they run out that whole bullpen trying to scrap their way through a midweek win.
What's really impressive about Charleston is the starting rotation. All three starters have gone at least 10-plus innings. They've pitched it well. And Ty Good, their Saturday starter, shut out Alabama in seven innings to help earn the win 1-0.
they're going to be a good club. They compete for championships. They compete, you know, late into the postseason. So no surprise there. And, you know, great matchup here tonight as well. 1-1 ball game in the bottom of the fifth is about all you can ask for.
William Privett is their best reliever out of the pen for Charleston. He's one of the top-rated arms in all the conference in terms of relief arms. He'll be a big arm for Charleston in late in this game. As Drake Pearson takes strike two. Pearson's trying to find his rhythm at the plate. He's hit 500, but very limited at-bats, just his fourth appearance of the year. Campbell on 1-2, gets him out in front.
A good swing there. One of the toughest jobs in baseball is going to be your DH or your spot start guys, guys that aren't able to establish a rhythm necessarily throughout a weekend, throughout a week, and a month, and so on and so forth through the season. So to come off the bench, to get a spot start, it's important to come in and give competitive at-bats, and that's what he's doing here tonight.
Pitch number 43 for Campbell tonight. Results in a punch-out. That's two Ks for Campbell.
And a very nice fastball, one of the better fastballs tonight from Campbell. That's a fastball that's starting off the inside corner of the plate and tailing right back onto the corner. Great execution on a two-strike inside corner.
Charleston is a pitching staff, top three in the league in strikeouts. That's been their bread and butter this year. Give them back-to-back Ks of Babin and Pearson. Now the top of the order with Waldy Arias. This game's so neatly contrasted. Charleston's had nine runners left on base, a lot of chances, whereas Campbell with a big pop early, the solo home run, but not as much in terms of production.
No, they definitely haven't been consistent. It seems like every inning, Charleston's just threatening. And it's going to wear on Campbell's pitching staff. We've seen their pitch counts a lot higher on that side of the board, and that will catch up to them. And it's especially important going into the weekend that they preserve as many arms as they can.
Because that's a huge challenge, too, for these clubs. Conference play doesn't start for Charleston until May 26th at UNCW, but in a year like this, conference play is going to matter more than any year before because RPI, it's just not going to help as much with the amount of ACC teams and teams in the SEC playing each other. It's going to be real tough to get an at-large this year.
And I'd be curious to see if they scored any differently. I don't know that they would or wouldn't, but you're right with ACC facing tough opponent night in and night out, and they're just going to get more credit for those wins and even for some of those losses.
Arias smacks a base hit the other way. First hit for Campbell since the third inning, and it comes from their leadoff man.
It's good to see Waldy get it going. We talked about him struggling with runners in scoring position here with nobody on, able to get it going. Great looking swing, punching that ball out into right center field.
Remember the year Charleston made the Super Regional, they were a at-large team. It was Wilmington who won the league title, and then Charleston got rolling. Of course, they make it to the Super Regionals. They beat Long Beach State in the regional final, a California team that both of us know so well, being California guys through and through. Zach Nutto drills the first pitch, sending a long run back for Sears. He looks up and it bounces off the wall. Extra bases for Nutto. Arias looking to take the lead at the plate, and he is in without a throw.
We talk a ton about his defense, but the bat will play too, and right there gets a pitch up in the zone, hammers it off the wall, but also a great job of Waldy understanding that ball is going to carry out there in center field over Sears' head. Instead of holding back closer to first, starts to extend towards second base, and that's what enables him to score as that ball kicks away from Sears off the pad.
First career triple for Zach Nutto, who's coming back healthy in this lineup and paying dividends tonight. Kind of the broadcaster jinx. We mentioned where was Campbell's offense? A hard hit single and a ball ripped off the wall in center.
That has been a bit of really the majority of Campbell's offense, though, this year. They score in bunches and they score quickly through doubles and home runs. And, you know, eventually they'll have to, you know, find themselves being a little bit more well-rounded. But so far this season, they've struck big through long balls and doubles and continuing true to form here tonight.
Connor Denning tries to add on to a one-run lead here in the fifth. Campbell's first real trouble in this inning. Gives up a line drive foul. We mentioned the conferences and how they all rank in the country. As you'd imagine, SEC and ACC, the top two leagues. But overall, out of what is 31 conferences, the Colonial has had a tough start, but they've really played well as of late. They sit in the mid-teens as Denning pops one foul. They're at 17 overall. A league that surprised you a bit is the Big South. They're the 20th-ranked conference in the country. Denning on 1-2. Can't catch up to that pitch. There's a strikeout. Third of the game for Connor Campbell getting Connor Denning of Campbell.
And a big strikeout it is. I mean, a guy that can hit the baseball as far as you can see. And you saw him early strike from the other side of the plate. That there, back right-handed, able to convert the strikeout. Big pitch with a man on third base.
Denning ranks top five in doubles, hits, and RBI in the Big South. Is quieted quickly. Big credit to Connor Campbell. That's just a tricky name to say when you face Connor Denning and Campbell right behind the backstop there as Packard takes strike one. Got to put the tongue twister cause in my contract for next year. Packard's hit everything hard tonight. Now down nothing in two.
He just does such a great job with two strikes. It seems like every time he comes up, he's in some sort of two-strike count, but able to stay through the baseball, work through the big part of the field, and seems like more often than not, he's finding barrel.
Connor Campbell just missed on the outer half. Zach Neto's RBI triple puts Campbell in front here in the fifth inning. Packer tries to cash him in with two gone by. And check this out. Packard's hitting 450 with two outs this year. Instead, he goes down swinging. Connor Campbell wins the battle. It's a one-run game through five.
There's not a secret to what actually happens behind the scenes at a bank. Here at First Citizens, we're trying to educate the client in each step of what's actually going to happen and actually have them make the educated decision around what steps and what options they utilize. We want to become that trusted advisor that actually guides them down that road, helping you reach your goals. That's Forever First.
Pepsi Wild Cherry.
Tired of cooking at home? Change it up without getting up. Just order Jersey Mike's through our app for no contact delivery or no contact at the door pickup. Jersey Mike's, be a sub above.
The doctor said I had prostate cancer. I needed to do something else. Can I go to proton therapy? Hampton University Proton Therapy Institute. He said, yeah, you can do it, man. So freeze, man. When I went for the treatments, there were no side effects. Whatever you could do before, you could do it after. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad I can go down there. But I tell you right now, I wanted to let those people know that I really appreciate it.
And HU is his spot. Cindy, when you call her up, she's not so nice on the phone. This is Jen. This is Ashley.
Chandler Williford warming up in the Campbell bullpen, the freshman from Newton Grove, North Carolina. He replaces a quality outing by Logan Heintzman as my brain turns back on here in the sixth inning. And Cole, certainly for Campbell, they're going to need that defense tonight. How about Zach Neto putting the team in front with a huge triple?
He's done such a great job. That's why they have him at the top of the lineup. He's a guy that comes off of injury, gets plugged right back in because they know what they're going to get. And competitive at bats, a little bit of power there, 395 off the center field wall. No surprise from him, just good to see him back healthy again in the lineup.
Justin Harris said after the loss to NC State, they did not play championship-level baseball. It seems like they've bounced back, went 2-3 over Gardner-Webb to open up the conference, and now leading by one as we roll into the sixth.
And I think they're definitely getting closer. It's been a good recovery. Anytime you come off a game like that, it's important to kind of right the ship and get a couple small victories coming back, trying to figure things out. And they've definitely looked better offensively. They've looked a ton better defensively, and I think if they can weed out some of the free passes from the pitching staff, they'd be in a pretty good spot.
Here's Luke Staggerberg in the heart of this Charleston lineup. He walked his first time up and takes strike one. Staggerberg trying to get going this year after he hit 310 in 2020. The average just below the Mendoza line as we enter tonight. And takes strike two. The one thing they have in the redshirt senior is experience, over 150 games played. Someone that Coach Holbrook can really trust in this lineup. Welliford rocks the breaking ball to extend the at-bat.
And a great swing there with two strikes. Really a nice breaking ball from Williford. A lot different than what you're going to see from Heintzman. That's more of the 12-6 big curveball, and really a nice job by Staggerberg staying through it, able to just fight it off and see another pitch.
Williford threw a scoreless inning last Tuesday at NC State. Here on the sixth tonight, gets his first punch out.
That breaking ball is going to be a weapon for him. It's a pitch he loves to go to right there. The big difference for the swing and miss is burying it on the inside corner. He does a great job of just inching it across that plate, creates a really tough matchup for Staggerberg, and a nice job of executing the pitch for the strikeout.
Williford redshirted all last year, did not intend to play. He's back in the bullpen this year. A biology pre-med major, very smart young man who misses high and away to McClendon Sears. McClendon has walked and singled tonight, one of the seven hits for the Cougars, but they have stranded nine on the bases.
And that's been the big missing piece for them is they do a great job of getting runners on. They've hit balls hard. They've taken walks. They've done different things to create opportunities. They're just a big hit or two away from really changing this ball game, and they haven't been able to find it.
There's a bunt attempt that's taken for a strike. We saw early in this game Charleston a couple of stolen base attempts. They were aggressive on the bags. Haven't been in the same realm late in this game. You do wonder if some of the small ball will play a factor for Coach Holbrook's club later as we go deep into the night.
You think that it might, but the second they went to Heintzman and he got the ball, you figured some of that running game is going to slow down just because of experience and understanding how to manage an offense. So, and he did a great job, come in, slow the roll, really change the pace of this game. And so now that they hand it over to Williford, we'll see if he's able to continue that trend or if he starts putting people on and allows them to execute their offense more freely.
Third outing for Williford, who in fact in 6 days celebrates his birthday. He's turning 20 on March 15th. They say 20 is the worst birthday you can have. Not much to celebrate. Here's a strikeout. Babin there to complete the process for back-to-back Ks.
20 is definitely not up there on the list of great birthdays.
You know what my favorite is, and this may seem a little bit a little bit immature, but I always enjoyed, just personally, I enjoyed turning like 13. Once you get to those teenage years, a little more responsibility, chance to have some fun, a little bit different.
Stay up a little later.
You get that curfew push back from like 9 to maybe 10:30.
Yeah.
All part of growing up. There's Matt Christian, the elder statesman on this team, who's going to be turning 25 later this year.
I was going to say, that's a guy he's seen a few birthdays. Be curious to see what, you know, if he agrees with us on this or 25, his insurance rates may go down a little bit. He, you know, just start to get different gifts as you get older.
Can also start renting a car
right at
some point as you get a little older. This is strike one. We did joke with Justin here, if the team had some COVID issues this year, Matt Christian could be the designated driver and take half the team in a separate group from the rest of the club that goes in two buses now.
It's nice to have. It's a good option there.
There's the 1-1 from Williford, who's already struck out two tonight. He's got Trotter Harlan, leadoff man who's been red hot at this top of the order for Charleston.
I love watching Babin catch with no runners on, see the low target he sets up, really just as a pitcher, has to instill a ton of confidence in you with him getting down so low and working underneath that baseball.
Harlan skies one into the air. Quick work for Chandler Williford in the sixth. preserving a one-run lead. Taking a look at the Campbell dugout here in the sixth inning. A club that came back after a disappointing loss at NC State. They take 2-3 over Gardner Webb. Now leading 2-1 as they roll to the bottom half of the sixth. Matthew Christian harpoons the first pitch in the right center. That's a long way to go on a high fly ball. Kind of the same type of swing from Christian three times in a row.
Yeah, definitely a very similar result. He just, you know, he's an inch or two off the barrel, and that's really the difference between a home run and a routine flyout at this level. It's just a couple inches, a couple milliseconds worth of timing. So he just seems to be a bit off tonight, not able to really follow up this weekend, but I don't know who would be able to follow up a couple grand slams. And
11 RBI in essentially two games.
Yeah, that's a tough act to follow up.
That was following a Friday night where Campbell nearly got no hit for, what, six, seven innings in that game. They finally got some offense, and in day two, it was the complete reversal, a couple of double-figure run scoring days. Colin Wolf down nothing in two as his bat looks to get going. Did single in the second. He's one for two tonight.
And this is a guy I think Campbell's just waiting on to start clicking, start hitting on all cylinders, because he's, you know, as a preseason player of the year, you know the expectations are there. You know the talent's there. It's just a matter of getting it all going, and sometimes early it can be a little tough, but he's a guy that's proven over the course of a long season he's going to have an impact. He's going to have an impact in the middle of the order.
One thing we have seen from Colin is the doubles, three extra base hits in these first 10 games. You do wonder if that'll translate to average. He climbs at 256. Did he get hit? I don't think he did. 2-2. Kind of checked with Jeff Francis real quick with this conversation. Just getting a clarification there, correct?
Yeah, I'm not quite sure what the discussion is. I think Wolf initially had asked for time.
Time to review if another umpire could check there possibly?
Possibly. It's definitely a tough angle with the ball skipping in and almost going behind Wolf, so I don't know if there was a great angle or any sound on impact, but
there is no instant replay in this ballpark or in the Big South Conference this year, so you can't necessarily review that. Instead, Wolf hits on 2-2. And rips one fair. Into the corner it goes. Who needs to get hit when he can rip a double in the right field?
I think he's going to be pretty happy they didn't end up granting him that hit by pitch. Anytime you're struggling just a little bit right there, punching the double down the right field line, great job of hitting. No surprise to see him with extra base hits, as you mentioned.
That's his fourth double. And yeah, you're certainly right on there, Cole. When Colin Wolf's hitting extra base hits, his bat is much better. That's a prime example right there.
That's what we're used to seeing. Two strike counts doesn't matter with Colin. He's a guy that competes. and he's an extra base hits weapon in the middle of that lineup. So if they're able to get him going, look for this Campbell offense to start building around him.
Four of the seven hits have come via extra base for Campbell tonight. The challenge has been driving in runs. Both these teams have had plenty of chances. 14 combined runners left on base. Grant Harris calls time as Connor Campbell eating a lot of innings here. Four innings, 64 pitches. Essentially a spot start. He's doing a great job keeping this game close.
He's done a really nice job pitching here in the sixth inning. When he came in, it's a tough situation. You're coming in against a potent offense in the middle of a game earlier than you'd probably anticipated, but it's time to, get ready to go, and he's done a great job of answering the bell.
The freshman, a new career high in pitches as well. He's now over 45, or in fact over 60 in this game. His previous high was 45. 1-1 to Harris, misses low and outside. And in his last outing, it was a tough go of it. One against USC Upstate, gave up four runs on three hits, but he has settled in, trying to go at least five innings here tonight.
Well, every day you go to the ballpark, it's going to be a different day, and sometimes you find yourself competing with stuff that isn't your best, but you find a way to get it done. Other days you feel great, and you just get absolutely rocked. So that's just kind of one of the funny pieces of baseball, and he's been able to find it here tonight. He's done a great job of keeping the reins on the Campbell offense.
The go-ahead run in the fifth on a RBI triple from Zach Neto. Wolf with a huge jump, but he holds off, and it's 3-1. Almost tempting the catcher there, Jared Kervin, with how big of a lead he gets.
It was a huge lead out there. It was very aggressive, jumping off, almost like he was intending to steal, but really no extra effort to steal the base, just cools it off into his secondary lead, and I think he's probably just looking to score on a single at this point.
He has scored 13 times this year on the bases as Harris takes strike two. That's an insane number in 10 games. I know the average has not been there for Colin, but when you're scoring that many times, it really changes the offense.
It does, and it shows you how many ways that he can contribute. Even when you're not going on offense, you're finding your way on base, you're taking your walks, you're hit by pitches, and you're finding a way to stay relevant in your lineup.
Runner is off. The payoff is smacked foul. That's a risky pitch to swing on. I know it's close, but I saw your reaction there, Cole. You wanted Harris to take that for ball four.
You do and you don't. You want your hitters to always take an aggressive approach to be ready to hit the baseball and deal with the consequences. But Wolf had it dead to rights, probably stolen standing up. But
3-2 does change the dynamic of that at bat.
It definitely does.
Connor Campbell on 3-2 goes to the breaking ball and gets the swing and a miss.
Really a nice job there by Campbell of resettling in, understanding the foul ball alleviates the stolen base. It's okay, reset, execute the breaking ball one pitch at a time, get your hitter now with two outs.
And the pitching coach, Will Dorton, is coming out to the hill. What an effort by Connor Campbell to keep this a one-run ball game. A pitching change might be in order here for College of Charleston.
You got to figure he's getting close to the end of his leash with the amount of pitches he's at, but what a great job he's done tonight.
Show you the bullpen here is right-handers getting loose for Charleston. Worth noting, it's Ty Babin, a left-hander, coming up next, and then Drake Pearson, who can hit from both sides. Brooks Lucas and Michael Schultz warming up for Charleston, and they'll keep the lefty in there, and Connor Campbell.
And I think that's one of those things where you kind of ask him how he's feeling with the left-on-left matchup, like you mentioned with Babin coming to the plate. That presents a really tough matchup for him offensively. I think he's bought himself at least one more hitter, possibly more depending on how it goes.
Two outs for the savvy fourth-year junior, Ty Babin. I was thinking of Colin Wolf there at second base. Wolf would be a huge insurance run off from second. He's playing in his 75th career game. following that double with one out. Babin takes ball two. Connor Campbell sitting on 4 1/3 innings of relief. This would be his biggest out with the bullpen warming up for Charleston. Babin making his second straight start behind the plate, and he waits on a 2-0. Gets a swing on it. 2-1. Seemed a little half-committal there on that swing.
He seemed a little hesitant, really, through his at-bats the last two games. Just a guy that hasn't gotten a ton of time at the plate, hasn't seen a ton of pitches. And here with Connor Campbell on the mound, it's a tough matchup with him throwing on the first base side of the mound and really coming from behind Babin. It's tough to pick up the baseball. And
so these are spots Babin lived in as a freshman. He hit .430 off the bench his first 2 years as a pitch hitter. Now he gets the start tonight in a critical spot in this 2-1 game. Campbell catches the corner to load the count. I was going to say, there's been a lot of energy in this ball game, and really the first real chance for Campbell to extend its lead.
It's felt a little bit tight, to be honest. It feels like both teams are kind of holding on and really hoping things go their way, and we haven't seen really either team take the initiative here, but you're right, not a ton of energy, maybe a little bit of nerves going on here early in the year.
Babin earns the walk, his second free pass.
And I would be surprised.
With two righties getting ready. I see what you're saying here with Connor Campbell. Here comes Kervin out to the mound. Charleston's bullpen has had an up and down start to this year. An excellent effort from Campbell. ERA of 5.7 as a relief appearance. They have two pitchers with saves. Brooks Lucas, who is actually warming up right there, number 23. You do wonder what Charleston plans to do here, especially with the right-hander Pearson coming up. Strike one. I like the call here from the Charleston coaching staff, trusting their lefty and trying to get an out here in the sixth inning.
Well, and if anything, he's earned himself a couple extra guys. He's thrown so great throughout this ball game, but they also may just feel more confident in him working. He has worked efficiently against right-handed hitters throughout this evening, so maybe they just feel confident in his stuff with the right-handed matchup.
Pearson skies it into the air and out of play. Will Dorton and this pitching staff led the CAA in ERA last year. That was their strength for College of Charleston, pitching the baseball. And if they're going to make moves this year, you think pitching would be a huge part of it as well this season. Pearson down nothing in two. And retires Pearson on three pitches. Good job by Connor Campbell to escape the threat. Let's head to the bottom of the sixth. Getting a look at Zach Netto coming in out of the pen as Campbell leads by one in this top of the seventh. Cole Netto pitched just one game last year. His bat has put this team in front tonight. How about the move to go to the utility player here on the hill?
Well, I think it's a great opportunity to get him in a game, get him in a big moment and see what he's got. They talk about how versatile all of his talents are, his wide skill set. So I'm excited to see him here in a big moment, get back on the mound and see what it looks like.
Chad Holbrook trying to find some offense late in the seventh inning. His club was picked second in the Colonial preseason poll. UNC Wilmington swept the awards in terms of preseason accolades, a very talented club for Randy Hood's team. That's taken for a strike for Joseph Menchon. Rashawn has singled in the first. He walked in the third and hit a hard ground ball to Christian his last time up. We mentioned Netto's success over the past summer here in Florida playing in a summer collegiate league. He was a great pitcher as well at that level. And you do wonder, Cole, you were a utility player. You've been in these spots. How you take the energy of hitting, swinging, doing all that stuff and coming right to the hill and trying to pitch?
Well, you just have to clear it all. Really, no matter what's going on in your mind, going on in, you know, so far in the game, you have to find a way to clear it and refocus on your new job. And right now his job isn't fielding ground balls and hitting doubles anymore. It's throwing strikes, getting outs, keeping his team in the game because, you know, this does have a regional feel to it. It's a 2-1 ball game in the seventh inning, and both teams chomping at the bit to score. It's intense in here, so great moment. Get him out there in the big stage, see what it looks like. But so far, he looks really good.
Rashawn takes low for ball two. This is a hitter with a tough weekend at Alabama, but very patient. More walks than strikeouts on the year. Netto in his first pitching appearance of the year. Comes from second base, kind of unique. And works the count full.
And we've talked about some of his throws, looking at his arm strength, like, you know, just, wow, that looks like a big arm. It looks like an arm that could play on the left side of the infield. And when he comes in, he's hitting 90, 91 miles an hour with his fastball. It all makes quite a bit of sense to the arm strength over there.
Certainly proves Justin Hare right, recruiting him out of Miami as a two-way player. The 3-2 is ripped foul. Netto's just a young kid, too. He turned 19 at the end of January, a second-year freshman, which is just a weird thing to say, by the way. It's not technically a red shirt. It's a COVID shirt, but you get the point. So the payoff pitch to Mershon is ball four.
And a big walk there. Typically, that's going to be the tough part about being a utility guy. He comes in, he throws a couple good fastballs, and gets ahead in the count, that's great, but do you have the put-away stuff? Are you as refined as, you know, a PO, a pitcher only, you know, would be with his breaking ball and his changeup? Like earlier we saw Heinzman go with the full count changeup for a big strikeout in a big situation. You wonder with Netto, has he had the time to develop those pitches? I think it's something we're going to see as this inning plays out.
Instead, the heart of the lineup for the Cougars, this is Harrison Hawkins. Nice stop by Babbitt, who finds the baseball and saves an extra base.
That's something we noticed in the second game Saturday of the doubleheader. Babbitt brought such an energy in behind the plate. He's so disciplined at receiving, but he's so energetic right there, really flying into that left-hander's batter's box to make a great save and hold the runner at first.
Netto misses inside. Another nice stop by Babin. And that's Captain Rashawn over at first base.
He's doing a great job. You wonder how many bullets Netto has in the tank. Guy that hasn't seen a ton of time on the mound. And, you know, how deep into this inning will they let him pitch if he does get in trouble?
Harrison Hawkins, who has two hits tonight. Big spot for the Cougars, down a run. Runner bluffs, that gets away from Babin, and an easy stolen base. I think you're spot on, Cole. You do wonder for Neto, who hasn't done this a lot in his career, going from playing defense to pitching, how you handle a little bit of adversity early.
It's tough, and you know a lot of guys can come in and throw fastballs for a strike, but you know when you play a team as good as College of Charleston, it takes more than that. It takes location. It takes multiple pitches for strikes and different counts to get hitters out. And so far, the fastballs look pretty decent. He's fallen behind here, but the breaking ball and the changeup have just been nowhere to be seen. And right there, he yanks that breaking ball for a wild pitch.
And misses on four straight to put two on with nobody out. As Campbell, Staffan only issued three walks coming into the inning. Now a major chance for the Cougars.
And I was kind of interested to see if we were going to get a mound visit just because of the situation starting to get pretty big for a young kid, especially a two-way player that plays the infield every day. He's more of a hitter-pitcher instead of a pitcher-hitter. Because that's where more of his time is allotted to. So you wonder if they'll try to slow it down on him or if he's composed enough to keep working. Understand he's a ground ball away from changing this inning and getting it back into where he wants it.
Ari Sakopoulos hitting in a huge spot with nobody out. And that's five straight bad misses for Neto.
It looks like we are going to get the mound visit from T-Rob running out there to slow his man down,
he's kind of more of a stroll, I would say. Kind of like a Sunday morning walk in the park.
He's a casual guy.
Does that demeanor translate to pitchers as well? I know there's all different spectrums of emotions, but how does that as a pitcher, how do you react to the emotions of your coach?
It's not good. It's never good. If you're a pitcher, the last thing you ever want is to see a coach leaving the dugout because it means either one, you're in a bit of a jam or you know a couple things aren't going your way or your night's over.
Neto was so critical at the plate. That's been the difference on the scoreboard as you see Jack Yusko warming up in the Campbell bullpen. And now for Neto, put the team ahead with a triple. I'm trying to save the game on the hill. Just a unique aspect to college baseball I think folks at home really love. Coppolis takes it inside for ball two.
Really good pitch there. Probably a pitch that Neto cost himself by being a bit wild early. Hasn't quite earned that strike yet. It's a borderline pitcher's pitch, but it's one that if you establish the strike zone early, a call you're more likely to get.
Neto on 2-0 has nowhere to put Coppolis. Gives up a high fly ball. It will stay in the park. Harris comes in on it. There's out number one.
And really a big missed opportunity there for Sakopoulos. Ahead in the count, 2-0, really trying to do too much there. Reaches for another fastball that's probably out of the zone. Really bails Neto out of a bad situation. Now he's a pitch away from getting out of it.
The demeanor of Neto has looked very locked in, even when things got out of hand, and credit to the second-year freshman for facing this adversity.
He's so calm, and it's just, you know, we've seen it on offense, we've seen it on defense, but to see him carry it to the mound, it's so hard to do something, you know, in three different aspects, especially when one of the things that you're practicing is going to get significantly less time.
Here's a line drive foul for Landon Showboy. The Cougars have left nine on the bases. They've had a ton of chances tonight. This is indicative of their offense trying to make something happen.
And you start to feel that pressure as an offense. You start to miss opportunities. You're aware that you weren't able to convert a couple guys on base with one out or two outs, but it starts to add up, and then you see guys get a little bit outside their comfort zone, and that's when it gets easier to pitch.
Runner heading to third. There's a stolen base. Crafty work for Mershon.
Really got a great jump there. I'm not sure that Hawkins was ready for it. Staying at first base, was not able to trail him and sneak into second also.
You saw Babin there. He was looking to second to throw it and kind of got surprised that allowed Mershon to easily take third.
And I think Babin understood with the set time of Neto, the delivery, and also the pitch being a breaking ball, the jump that Mervin got to going to third base, he really had no chance. You got to throw backside there, but the runner in Hawkins holds at first base and doesn't attempt the second.
That's his seventh steal of the year from Rashawn. Neto gets a ground ball. It's still nothing in two.
Neto's also got to refocus and understand that doesn't matter. If he's able to get his ground ball here, you can still turn two. You can still get out of your inning.
Each team with seven hits. The difference has been a triple from Zach Neto, who now takes the hill, facing a tight jam in this inning. Gives up a fly ball. Choboy pops it in the air. Denning the catch. But he lost the ball on the transfer, and Charleston ties it. Critical mistake from Connor Denning evens us as two.
And we're going to get an appeal here to third base. Calling him safe. I was concerned about it as well. It looked like he may have left a bit early, but gets a safe call. We're tied up here in the seventh inning.
A lot going through Connor Denning's mind on that play, but it certainly seems like one he could have made.
It was definitely a great – that's what you dream of as an outfielder. You dream of a chance to throw, coming in on a baseball, and really being able to unleash it to home. Right there, little case of trying to make the throw before you ensure the catch, and that one gets away from him on the transfer.
Two outs for Donald Hansis. Now Charleston has been sitting on the edge of breaking open offensively. They have a crucial opportunity here in the seventh.
And you mentioned earlier if we're going to see base stealing play a factor later in this game. And right there, they essentially stole a run just by stealing third, enabling that sack fly to take place.
Otherwise, you're right, it'd still be a 2-1 ball game. Hansis chops one in front of the plate. Neto, the utility man, gets it done. Not before Charleston ties us at two as we go to the bottom of the seventh.
We are not merely an institution of higher education. We are transforming lives and empowering students to become leaders.
Leaders in our communities,
in our state, and throughout the world.
Leaders in innovation.
Leaders in service to our neighbors.
Join our movement. Join our community. Join our mission. Lead with purpose. Lead with Campbell.
Crust is the most important part of stuffed crust.
It's half the name.
Papa John's crust is made from 6 simple ingredients. 7 if you count all this cheese. Better ingredients, better pizza, Papa John's. Papa John's is known for its crispy, fresh crust full of warm, fluffy pockets. And now they're known for stuffing those pockets with cheese. I love you, cheese. Get a new epic stuffed crust pizza with one topping for just $12. Papa John's.
In the last 10 years, Emerge Orthopedics has really been on the forefront of doing orthopedic urgent care. We realize that a lot of these accidents happen after hours, and patients want to get seen and get diagnosed and get taken care of. Emerge has a number of orthopedic urgent cares throughout the Triangle, and some of which are open 7 days a week, open till 9 o'clock at night. And that's been a huge benefit to patients. Patients routinely give us compliments on that and the care they receive there.
Welcome back to Jim Perry Stadium. Good ball game in the bottom of the seventh. All squared at two. The first meeting between these clubs since 2015, where, as you guessed it, each team split the series. Campbell won at Charleston. The Cougars won here in Buies Creek. Maybe not a barn burner for Spencer Packard. He's kind of hanging out in the dugout, but it's a great game here tonight.
Well, everybody's got their own routine, their own things that, you know, get their mind ready to hit. And, you know, I was a chiller guy, had to try and relax and not try and take it to the game. And I assume he's probably just trying to take it in and refocus his approach to keep working, because this one's gotten tight in a hurry here, tied up 2-2 in the bottom of the seventh.
Here's Michael Schultz in relief. This is his first outing of the season. He's only thrown 3 innings in his career, but now inherits a fantastic outing from Connor Campbell to keep this game within striking distance. He went 4 2/3, gave up 1 run, and now Schultz inherits a tight spot. Waldy Arias in the top of this Campbell lineup gets things started. He takes the first pitch for strike one. I do love the confidence of Coach Holbrook going to a new arm that has not appeared this season and letting it fly here in a tie ball game.
They must like what they see, but it's also just a great opportunity to get people in, especially arms that are competitive that you know are ready for the moment. Saw something similar with Neto last inning. Great chance for Coach Hare to get him in and see if he's a guy that can play second base for the majority of the game and then be a plug on the mound, you know, in big moments. So similar situation here of let's get these guys in there. Let's see what they're made of when the bright lights are on and we're 2-2 tied up in the final innings of this game.
Schultz in three innings over these last couple of years. A 357 batting average again. Something he'll have to work on against the heart of this lineup. And gets the strikeout. How about that pitch with some good movement?
Well, he looks like he's coming straight over the top. Typically a fastball you think would be pretty flat and really coming right at you, but that pitch starts off the plate, tails right over on Waldy with some arm side run, picking up the strike.
Running and gunning for the punch out. Eight combined Ks for the Charleston bullpen. Now this is unique. The pitcher, Zach Neto, will hit in this spot in the order, which does do a couple of changes to how the lineup presents itself. Neto down nothing and one.
Yeah, this is a move most coaches are not familiar with. Anytime you have a two-way guy that is actually a contributor on both sides, it's not overly common, but we'll see if Neto's able to stay in the game. We've seen how good he's been offensively. It's, you know, now can he carry it over at the plate?
He's looking to change the score with one swing, and it's nothing and two. If Neto is taken out of the game, they can also keep him in as the DH and do a double switch as well. So there's a lot of options you can do here with Justin Hare's lineup. Here's the 0-2 from Schultz. Forces weak contact, takes a dangerous hop, and a long throw for Mershon is late.
We've talked about his range on defense and now showing off that speed down the line. Really a great play over there by Mershon, even making the grab right down the line. Doesn't have a ton of chance, but makes it a bang-bang play at first, doesn't get the call. Still a nice defensive play.
Zach Neto with his second straight hit. And now the head coach, Chad Holbrook, wants a quick discussion to see if he could challenge the call here. At least get a second opinion on it. I also noticed Coach Holbrook kind of forgot his mask in that conversation. I guess it has happened from time to time.
There's probably going to be a little learning curve with some of these new things there, but
I know one of the initiatives in college baseball, they don't want coaches and umpires to have face-to-face confrontations, especially with some of the COVID procedures.
How well do you think that one's going to hold up?
I imagine if it's an NCAA rule, it's going to have some weight to it. At least a recommendation. I wouldn't say a mandate, but here's one thing I mandate from you, Cole. What's it going to take for either of these teams to finally jump ahead?
It's going to have to be a big hit with runners in scoring position. They just haven't come through really on either side. Both teams have had their chances. Neither's been able to grasp it.
Runner is off. Great throw to second. And in there safely is Neto.
And there's some fancy work around that bag on the slide. It looked like he almost gave Harlan a swim move there at second base because the ball looked like beat him initially, but way to sneak in there, get a hand in there to get safe.
Zach Neto with his Campbell offense, 20 stolen bases on the year. Pretty nifty handwork by the oven mitt.
This would be a huge answer back from Campbell here if they're able to get one, reestablish their lead here in the bottom seven.
Oh, that foul ball hits Packard. That's the on-deck hitter, Spencer Packard, getting plunked. That is something you don't see too often.
No, it hit him square. It looks like in the forearm, trying to shake it off. But I'll tell you what, big man wore it like a champ and barely flinched. I don't know that he had much time to, but.
There's Callie Hannon, the athletic trainer, with the mask on right there, talking to Packard along with the head coach. Those stingers can really hurt, and sometimes they just come out of nowhere too.
Yeah, you start to get kind of a frog in your forearm. Your grip gets a little weaker. It can change your swing, but that's a scary moment. He's lucky it only got him in the arm, and he's able to stay in there.
We will certainly see when he comes to the plate, but we hope the best for Spencer Packard, the fifth-year senior. Denning holds up. Yes, he does. It's 2-2.
So impressive, his hands right there. He was full go right until the last minute, but to have such good hands and back control on both sides of the plate is truly impressive.
Good environment here with students and faculty staff allowed at Campbell University. 2-2 ball game in the seventh as Michael Schultz pitches in a jam. Denning fouled it off. Third outing for Schultz, who gave up two runs against Georgia State, his last time out. Or against Georgia Southern, I should say. Connor Denning, the hottest hitter in Campbell's lineup coming into tonight. Gets a home run in the first and now looking to get his bat going here in the seventh. Ground ball to first. Good snag for the second out.
Nice scoop over there by Sakopoulos. Probably a ball Denning wants back. Just gets in on him, but with two strikes, really a nice pitch there by Schultz to get in on his hands for some weak contact.
Feels like this game has come down to the utility man, Zach Netto. A triple. He's gotten a couple outs on the hill, and now he's at third base with a steal. Represents the go-ahead run here with two gone by. Here comes Curvin for a quick chat.
We've been waiting for a big hit with runners in scoring position. You got to wonder, is this going to be the moment? If not, when is it going to come? Because both teams have had opportunities, and here they're running out of time here late.
Remember, Charleston's left 10 on the bases. Campbell has left 7. And now Michael Schultz facing a tight spot with a lefty getting loose in the Charleston pen. Here's Spencer Packard, who has already doubled and singled tonight. An intentional walk to Spencer Packard. Sets the stage for Matt Christian, which is not an easy task if you're going to walk anybody.
No, and that's one of the more difficult coaching decisions I've seen, is to walk a great left-handed hitter to get to possibly the hottest hitter in Campbell's lineup, especially hitting the long ball. So it doesn't get any easier here, even though it's a right-on-right matchup with Matthew Christian coming to the plate.
I love the decisions being made tonight. A lot of regional-level type thinking to this midweek game. It brings a neat aspect to a 2-2 ball game in the seventh. And here's Matt Christian. Schultz wants a new sign as he steps off. This Charleston bullpen called in the second inning. They've held Campbell to one run here in relief. The Cougars tied it in the top half on sacrifice fly. Christian takes ball one. We mentioned how teams have to bring their own energy to a ballpark. In a game like this, it certainly feels like the energy is really translated more to the players and less to the actual environment.
There's definitely there's a ton of feel with the players. These guys are, you know, competing. They're being careful, but you can tell they understand it's a big moment.
Christian smacks one foul off both the umpire and the catcher for strike one. Because in the past we've seen, whether it's the pitching side or the hitting side, these dugouts, they're rattling the cage. They're banging the dugout. They're trying to make some noise. It's just a little bit more focused and determined tonight.
It is. It's a big moment. These guys know what's on the line, and you know, I think they're definitely happy to have some fan noise back in the stadium, but they're perfectly happy to compete with one another, with anybody here or not, and that's what you're seeing tonight, is two great competitive teams really going at each other.
Here's the 1-1. Packard is off. Nice scoop at third. And there you go. Charleston gets out of the jam. We go to the eighth, all squared at two here on ESPN Plus. Zach Netto back to work here for the eighth inning in a 2-2 ball game. Campbell leads this all-time series 14-12, and as you'd expect, Cole, pretty competitive game here tonight.
It is. I'm interested to see who's going to come up with that big hit. That's what it's going to take. It's going to take one big punch or possibly a long ball. I think, you know, if either one of these teams are able to put one on the board, I think they're going to get out of here with a win. I think it'll finish up 3-2.
Charleston won the last time these teams met in Buies Creek, 10-3. Cole, you were part of that game. You were part of this series. And two interstate teams, North South Carolina, they don't play each other too often with the Colonial and Big South, but these are two of the best in both the Big South and the CAA.
You got to love it. I always enjoyed going to their place, loved having them at ours as well, just because you knew what you're going to get. You're going to get a team that's going to come in and really prepare you for down the stretch. They're a team with regional aspirations. And, you know, there's nothing better than facing those tough opponents. Midweek, weekend, doesn't matter, so. Now I'm excited to be on this side of it, getting to watch it and see what it's all about.
You know what's unique about this matchup? Campbell and the Big South will play 10 non-conference games and 40 games in the conference. Tonight's contest is already game 8 of their non-conference schedule. That's taken for a strike to start off this inning by Jared Kirvin, the Charleston catcher.
And if I'm not mistaken, we're going to get some midweek conference matchups as well, correct?
That'll start next week with Campbell taking on Winthrop on the road.
Those are the games I'm also interested to see because it's such a different dynamic. Playing a conference game midweek, there's no games where you're just hoping to get by. These are games that matter, and you know, if an at-large bid isn't at stake, you have to win the conference. You got to put yourself in a good seed for the tournament, so.
And
those
more importantly,
are
you got to make the tournament. Both these schools, the CAA and the Big South, are shrinking the size of their tournament. Not as many teams get in. So uber important to do well in the regular season. Here's the 0-2 from Netto. Comes and running the bases to throwing two good breaking balls in a row.
He looks good. He looks like he's settled in. He's got himself a clean inning out there. And, you know, sometimes as a pitcher when things don't get off the way you want them to, but you're able to kind of skate out of it. You know, for the most part unscathed, it's great to just get back out there, find your rhythm again, and get back to work.
Second inning of the season for Netto, who has played a lot of second base this year. He's a dual threat, both pitching and in the defensive side. Got him with a slider. First punch out for Netto.
And a great job with the slider, essentially throwing slider off of slider there. Hang with me for a second. So, he hangs the slider up, throwing it for more of a strike. It's not going to be as sharp, but starts that one. That's the best one he's got in his pocket. So that one starts on the black, comes out real firm and straight, and dives off the plate. Completely different pitch, but same pitch name-wise, I guess, if you will.
So it's like an Olive Garden unlimited breadstick and salad bowl. It starts great, but then it gets better and better each
time
you throw it.
Exactly right.
Okay. Glad we found a reference there. So there's strike one to Luke Stagerberg. Luke 0-for-2 tonight, but did walk in this ballgame. That forced Cade Boxrucker out of the game after just two innings. Heintzman and Williford got us to this point. Now Zach Netto in his second inning of relief. There's strike two.
And we'll see if he goes back to the slider. This is a great chance for him with the sharp, firm slider to throw a back footer to a left-handed hitter. Unfortunately for Netto, it's one of the hardest pitches to throw in the entire game because if you miss over the plate, it's probably going to get hammered. And if you yank it at all, you're giving away a free pass on a hit-by-pitch. But definitely a go-to with a right-on-left matchup.
Here's the 0-2 pitch. Netto is cruising, playing his own position, and making the throw for the second out.
And I'll say I feel pretty good out there with Netto fielding his own position. Probably the guy you want out there as soon as he grabs the ball, no second thought, fires it over to first base for the out.
Is there another pitcher on this staff you trust more making a play like that? Because it's got to be Netto, right?
It has to be Netto. I was a two-way guy. I felt pretty confident in my abilities. I want to pass it on to Netto and give him that two-way bias.
How about Thomas Harrington, though? Pretty athletic freshman pitcher.
I feel good about him as well, but I got to give the nod to my guy Netto out there.
Missing outside this time to McClendon Sears, who has one of the seven hits for the Cougars tonight. In the odd stat, they have seven hits, just Charleston, but 10 runners left on base. Campbell has left nine, so both teams have had their chances.
Whichever team doesn't come out of here with a win is going to have a tough look in the mirror, leaving that many guys on base.
1-1. These teams are meeting just once. It's not a home-and-home series. A matchup that was actually scheduled just a couple of months ago. It was changed a few times with dates and times, but it's good these teams get to square up. The first meeting in 6 years for the two clubs. Zach Netto missing that time, but settling in nicely here in his second inning of relief.
He does. He looks a ton better, and you know, I'd love to see more of this matchup. I'd love to see a weekend set, two teams that are really trying to put themselves on the map and prove what they're all about. I'd love to see it, you know, be a regular thing every season, go down and, you know, have them come up the next year. And it's hard to beat this quality baseball that we've seen tonight. And I think it's good for both teams in preparation for what they're going to get in conference.
2-1 is drilled in the left field. Clutch two-out single by McClendon Sears.
Sears didn't miss an ounce of that baseball. That's a fastball right over the middle of the plate from Netto there that he absolutely hammers through the sixth hole to pick up a single and extend the inning.
Now batting number one, Trotter Harlan.
First hit that Netto has allowed here in relief. And all of a sudden, the top of the order coming up for the College of Charleston. You mentioned some of the non-conference scheduling for CFC. How about this? They'll play at Clemson, at Coastal Carolina, at Wofford, always a good matchup. And then home and home with the Citadel, so a very daunting schedule along with Charlotte next week. Yeah.
It's also a schedule with the expectations that they've placed on themselves that they're going to go try and take advantage of, try to build that RPI early and put their name in the mix for an at-large.
You know, a 3-7 record does make that a bit tough, but one thing we know with Chad Holbrook's club, they're going to compete, especially after going off to such a great start last year, 12-2. One of the darlings of the CAA until COVID shut down the remainder of the season.
I think what you typically find, you get off to a 12-2 start, you're probably not as good as your 12-2 start, and they're definitely not as bad as their 3-7 start this year. We're going to find out, but typically those things, you know, good ball clubs find a way to win games over the course of a season.
Make it 2-0. I guess the question is that interlocks all these teams. How talented is USC Upstate if they can go down to Charleston and sweep a series and they'll head here to Buies Creek to take on Campbell this upcoming weekend?
That's going to be an absolute blast to see what they're all about. They've been beating everybody inside and have showed – No chance of slowing down, but with Campbell being the reigning champions, what a great opportunity for them to come in and prove a point as the new guys in the conference.
Trotter Harlan able to fight off another pitch to extend the set bat. Charleston tied it in the seventh on a sacrifice fly. really that was a run that was stolen away. Joseph Mershon with a great steal, able to slide in on that sack fly. And now we got a 2-2 game. The 2-1 is drilled out to center. Denning went in, now goes back, making the catch. We head to the bottom of the eighth, still tied at 2. One of the best midweek games you're going to see in terms of talented teams at the top of their leagues. College of Charleston picks second in the CAA. Campbell, the preseason favorites in the Big South, and we're tied at 2 in the bottom of the eighth. How about this final tonight? USC Upstate goes into Clemson just down the road. They win 12-2 behind a 3-for-5 effort from Jack Gallagher, who had 7 RBI. The Spartans are now 10-0. Not only a sweep of College of Charleston, but a big one over Clemson tonight.
And after you beat Clemson 12-2, that's really, you know, that's a nail in the coffin there. That shows, you know, we're for real. We can go into different conferences and beat the big dogs. So it just adds to how great the weekend's going to be with them coming to town.
They brought in a closer in Kevin Davis, who's 6'9", 270, through a couple innings of scoreless relief. And this Upstate team was a sneaky, trendy pick in the league to make runs in the Big South. They already swept their opening series and are now at 10-0.
And they're showing that it's well worth it, making those people look pretty good.
Colin Wolf, the player of the year in the conference in the preseason, pops this up to left, and he is retired. Bottom third of the Campbell lineup coming up, and it sort of feels like in a game of this magnitude, it's going to take more than one swing to win it after Wolf pops out.
It may take more than one swing, but as hard as runs have been to come by, I don't think it'll take more than one run. I think 3-2, get a closer involved, and you guys will be, you know, down the road with a win.
Grant Harris working behind in the count. He's 0-for-3 tonight, getting the start in right field. I'm just scintillating about that Upstate series as well, given how talented that team is. We saw Charleston battle with them in 2 of the 3 games, including a 13-10 final with 5 lead changes in the last couple innings. It was back and forth. Upstate did sweep the weekend, but a couple of clubs interlocked together as Harris picks out a one-out single.
And I think Harris is going to be pretty relieved. He's hit all 3 balls tonight just on the screws right there. Ball's drilled right back up the middle, right where it came from. Good piece of hitting from him. I'm sure he's glad to finally get one to fall after barreling up all his prior at-bats.
So with one out, Ty Babin digs in. He's got a couple of walks tonight. But boy, would he love to kickstart his bat at the plate. In a swing inning, we saw Cade Keeler and Jack Uskel warm up in the bullpen earlier. You do wonder, if Campbell takes the lead, how they'll handle this from a pitching side of things.
Well, they talk about the depth of arms that they have out there. You'd be curious, do we see Westlake again in a closer role? What, you know, exactly what we're going to have, we don't know. But I would love to see Babin really just, you know, guess fastball, try to get hot and get lucky. And, you know, you could change this game in one swing.
Babin skies it in the air. Long way to go for Kervin and cannot get there. Charleston still has a big gun in the bullpen. Trey Pooser, who was the strikeout leader in relief. A lot of options for the Cougars as well before they get set to face William & Mary this weekend. One and two to Babin. It is unique in that aspect. Both these clubs have conference series coming up. You want to win this game, but you also want to get ready for critical series on Friday.
You're exactly right. The last thing these guys want to do is play for another six or seven innings. They want to put a run on the board, wrap this thing up, get your closer some time in the game, and then get back on the bus.
There's the 1-2. Schultz misses outside. A three-pitcher mix for Charleston tonight. Grenier inning in a third. Campbell, 4 2/3, really bridged the gap on the left side. And then Schultz entered last inning. Here he is now with one out in the eighth. Babin off the end of his bat. There's the second out. Advancing the go-ahead run to second in Grant Harris.
Really a nice job of Schultz staying with that baseball just off the cap of Babin's bat. And then if you didn't notice, gathers it and throws an absolute seed over to first base. Ton of confidence in his fielding ability as well.
So here's a pitch hitter for Campbell. Lawson Harrell slides into this DH spot. Freshman of Selby, North Carolina. Maybe his biggest at-bat of the season. Schultz trying to keep this a tie game here in the eighth. Pounds ball one inside. Lawson Harrell, a 200 hitter on the year. And he'd love to pick up that first big hit. He's got three RBI, but moments like this are a little bit different for the second-year freshman.
And you talk about the biggest at-bat of his season, maybe the biggest at-bat of his career. Here against a great opponent, finally able to get in the box in a big moment.
2-0. The top of the order coming up next, all trying to cash in. Grant Harris over there at second. The Campbell team that is 0-10 with men in scoring position. Harrell might get the job done here. Into the corner it goes and down for extra bases. Harris scores the go-ahead run. Lawson Harrell wants third. And a clutch two-out triple puts the Camels in front.
Definitely the biggest at-bat of his career now as the freshman comes in off the bench and delivers a two-out triple, picks up the RBI. I think that may be all it takes, but what a great swing, especially off the bench, coming in against a good arm in Schultz that's had success all night. Shows a lot about his preparation, his poise up there in the box.
Justin Hare talks about players filling voids and stepping into roles. What a bigger spot than Lawson Harrell here in the eighth inning.
You can't speak higher of the freshman than just giving him that opportunity. So it just shows the faith that Coach Hare has in him.
Here comes the pitching coach out for a quick chat. Not a bad pitch by Schultz either. It was just perfectly placed down the line.
It's a two-strike fastball. He's a little bit late on it, but fights his hands to the front, really just knows he's got to hang in there and really fight that pitch off and does a great job. It tails towards the line, stays fair, and he slides into third base with a triple. That's what you got to do with two strikes.
So Will Dorton heads back to his quarters. Now with two outs, the inning continues for Waldiaries. Arias takes strike one on a good fastball. The last time these teams met in 2016, Campbell won that game 2-0 at Charleston. That was part of a 20-5 start. Charleston went 14-7 in that stretch, that made the Super Regional. A couple years later, Arias grounds out to short, and we go to the ninth inning. Who's going to win this one? Comes down to the final three outs, and it's next here on ESPN Plus.
Power isn't born. It's built over time. For over 65 years, Hercules Tires has been providing the muscle to move more drivers. Whatever the vehicle, whatever the terrain, and we back it with a powerful protection plan. So wherever the road or the trail takes you, we have the selection, value, and strength to get you there. Hercules Tires, ride on our strength.
Our new house is amazing. Great street, huge yard.
There is a bit of an issue with our neighbor's fencing. At least Geico makes bundling our home and car insurance easy.
Which helps us save even more.
Hey, Sarah. Hey, Peter.
Push it.
For bundling made easy, go to geico.com.
Thank you, Wendell. We are not merely an institution of higher education. We are transforming lives and empowering students to become leaders.
Leaders in our communities, in our state, and throughout the world.
Leaders in innovation.
Leaders in service to our neighbors.
Join our movement. Join our community. Join our mission. Lead with purpose. Lead with Campbell.
Kevin Westlake enters the ball game here in the ninth, looking for the save following the RBI triple by Lawson Harrell. Campbell going at a former starter in Westlake, now in the closer's role this year. He tries to lock down the final three outs of this ball game.
Well, for a new season, there's a new role, and not any quite as exciting as the closer role. It's for the adrenaline junkies, the guys that love the big moment and want to go out there and get after it. So they thought his personality was a good mix. We've seen him a time or two this season so far, and looking forward to see him here against College of Charleston with everything on the line and a one-run lead.
Westlake picked up a save in his debut against Liberty, and now in four innings of work, yet to give up a run. What's the challenge of transitioning from being a starting pitcher to now being a reliever and ultimately a closer?
Well, there's no room for error. Typically, as a starter, you're going to go 5-6 innings, and you know you're going to give up one or two, and that's okay because your offense is going to come through for you. But when you're a closer, there is no room for error. You're a pitch away from this game being tied, and you're two pitches away from it being over. So you have to understand that moment. You have to be able to thrive in those high-stakes pressure moments, and that's what makes a closer. It's the guys that can handle the situation more so than the stuff.
Great to see these teams meeting again. College of Charleston and Campbell, two of the favorites in their respective leagues, the Colonial and the Big South. It comes down to this top of the ninth inning, 2-3-4 in the Charleston lineup. And Joseph Mershon will lead things off. Kevin Westlake working for his second save of the year, misses low. There was a bugaboo for Westlake as a starter. It was control issues. One thing Justin Hare told us coming into the year, Westlake has embraced the ability to maybe overextend himself and focus on this one inning.
You're going to find that that's common. A lot of guys that pitch in the back end of games have, they're either two-pitch guys and can't be starters, or they have some control issues, can't be starters. But for some reason, when you slot them into that ninth inning and tell them, we need three outs, doesn't matter what it takes, doesn't matter how many pitches, just go out there and get them. It just clears their mind, enables them to go to work and really deliver their best stuff without thinking too far into the future and trying to withhold for more innings.
It's 3-0 to Mershon. Westlake this year, six strikeouts, and to your point, only one walk. As a starter, it was nearly 50-50.
It gets tough as a starter. You can start nitpicking, and next thing you know, you're down 2-0, 3-0 to a four-hole guy, and the last thing you want to do is throw one over the middle. So as a closer, it's your job. It's your best stuff versus their best stuff. Go get after it, and we'll deal with the consequences.
There's strike one for Westlake against Mershon, who's been swinging the bat well, average well above 340. His first series of the year had four RBI against NCA&T. And now a critical spot for Marshawn has reached base three times tonight. Strike two. Patient hitter against a patient pitcher. No better matchup here in the ninth.
No, but I think it's definitely huge for Westlake to record this out, because if he does get on, you open up the bunt opportunity, you open up stolen bases, and that's where things get wiry as a closer. You're a guy that's not hugely in tune with having runners on base all the time.
The payoff pitch is swung on and missed.
That's just the start Westlake was looking for. Falling behind early, not necessarily with bad pitches. He essentially outlined the strike zone, just wasn't able to get the call. So right there, does a great job of answering back. Shows how lethal that fastball is with.
Yeah, how about the confidence to go heater, heater, heater?
It's impressive. It shows it's got a little bit of velocity to it, but it's also got some arm side run. It's a tough pitch to hit even if you know it's coming.
Here's Harrison Hawkins with one out, taking strike one.
And if he can do that right there, strike one at the knees with the fastball, he's going to have a lot of success in this role.
Hawkins has two hits in his first two at-bats. Trying to extend this game by reaching base. Ground ball. Wolf to his left. Nice throw over to first for the second out.
Really a nice job by Wolf, ranging to his left side, understands the most important thing is to get that ball airborne. Doesn't necessarily take you rearing back, trying to fire a bullet. It's just get the ball airborne, moving towards first base because it's faster than the runner. Right there, does a great job of gunning it across the diamond.
Notice as well, Campbell's able to implore the DH perfectly. Neto goes back to second base as the pitcher, and Wolf slides over to short.
Got to give credit where it's due.
Final chance for the Cougars. This is Ari Sakopoulos taking ball one. Sakopoulos has one of eight hits for Charleston. They have stranded 11 on the bases, and now it comes down to this with two outs in the ninth. Westlake wants his second save of the season, and he's got strike one. A senior who was a starting pitcher all throughout his high school and junior college career, taking a new approach here in his senior season, and it's paid off quite nicely.
And I don't know how you feel about it, but I love the way he looks up there. It's a completely different Westlake on the mound. He's so competitive and really just emptying it all, trying to get three guys.
2-1 to Sakopoulos. He has some pop, three doubles and three RBI on the year. And then if Sakopoulos is able to reach, it's the big bat in the lineup, Landon Choboy, who's been red hot with a couple of hits tonight. Westlake misses ball three.
And this is the guy he wants at the plate. The last thing he wants to do is bring up Choboy. He wants to get his left-hander and get him now.
Westlake earned the series win in his last outing against Gardner Webb. His fourth appearance of the year, and it comes down to this with two outs. Line drive foul, now 3-2. Westlake got a save in his debut. Now he tries to close out this exciting midweek matchup with two quality ball clubs tonight. The big difference, a run in the eighth and a Lawson Harrell RBI triple. There's the ball game right here. Payoff pitch to the plate. Ground ball to Arias. This should do it. Westlake gets the save, and Campbell, a run in the eighth to take the lead, shuts it down here in the ninth.
Really a hard-fought game by Campbell. I think it's exactly what Coach Hare wanted from this team is, you know, get in a fight with a great ball club, see what you're made of. And right here, not everything went their way, but they hung in there for the long haul, able to find a way to get it done late and convert it for a win. Really shows the makings of what could be a very good ball club down the stretch.
A 3-2 final here in Buies Creek as Zach Neto, the pitcher and second baseman, gets the win. The save for Westlake as Campbell moves to 7-4. Charleston drops to 3-8. For Cole Hallam, I'm Evan Budrovich, along with our hardworking crew in the trailer. We want to thank you for watching this game tonight. Remember, you can watch this broadcast on the ESPN app and ESPN.com. But for us here tonight in Buies Creek, North Carolina, signing off, Campbell a 3-2 win over the College of Charleston.